The Save Mart Supermarkets 300 NASCAR Winston Cup Race. It's a beautiful day here, a little cool because of some windy conditions, but we are within one lap of starting this 74-lap event at Sears Point. First of two road course races for the year. Mark Martin off a tremendous win last weekend at Talladega. Let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch.
Thanks, Bob. And remember last August, the last time on a road course, Mark Martin set on the pole and dominated the day, but they didn't bring the same car here. They built a special car to come here to Sears Point, a car that will turn left because at Watkins Glen, you turn right all day. Left-hand turns, very critical on this 12-turn road course. Now, Ned Jarrett, road racing cars get more and more sophisticated year after year.
They really do, Jerry. Far cry from the way we used to race. We'd bring a short track car to a road course just to reverse the settings on the car. Why not? Most of the turns on a road course are similar to those on a short track. The only difference is they go in the opposite direction. I'm up in turn 7 where we see a lot of action here. One of a very few places on this racetrack that you can pass on, but it's a tough one to pass on. Down where Benny Parsons is, it's also a tough place to pass, but they can do it.
Yes, Ned, I'm down in turn 11, the slowest corner on this racetrack and maybe the slowest corner in all of NASCAR Winston Cup racing. These cars get down to about 35 miles per hour, but a great place to pass going in the corner, also a great place as they accelerate off turn 11. John Kernan.
Benny, some new rules in effect today for everybody. They've taken the front air dam clearance. They've raised it from 3 3/4 to 4 inches. And the rear spoiler height, they've reduced that from 6 1/4 down to 5 3/4. Now, this is where the Chevrolets will stay when we go to Charlotte in a couple of weeks. But the Fords and the Pontiacs will go to 6 inches on their rear spoiler height and back to 3 3/4 inches ground clearance on their front nose. Now, Bob, everybody here in the garage area says we don't know how that's going to affect the competition until they actually drop the green flag.
And that's coming up in just a few moments, John. Here's the race analysis for you. Our pole speed was 92.1 miles an hour. We'll go 74 laps. The race record is 81.4. They're going to have to pit between laps 25 and 30 for fuel, and the purse is in excess of $1 million. They head for turn number 7 here, and while they do, let's take a look at the starting lineup. Winning his fourth pole position here at Sears Point in 7 races is rookie Rudd. Terry Labonte starts alongside. We got Martin, Earnhardt, Gordon, and Wallace in the top 6. Kenny Schrader is expected to run very well here today. Kyle Petty starting 8th. And now let's take a look at 16 through 30 in the starting lineup. Hut Strickland leads that list. Darrell Waltrips is there in 17th position in number 17. All the way down to number 21, Morgan Shepherd, who's going to have to go to the back of the pack for the start because he missed rider introductions. Dr. Jerry Punch is with the defending champion of this event, Ernie Irvin.
And Bob, it's a pleasure. He had surgery here on Friday in San Francisco. And Ernie, you just got to the racetrack. How do you feel?
I feel really good. You know, surgery went good, and everything's uphill battle from now. But we'll be racing pretty soon.
A lot of people asking why you had it done and what was done, but basically in a hurry. I'm told that it's to expedite the recovery process.
Yeah, it is. You know, it's something that that we've knew all along and didn't know if it was going to heal itself. And you know, now the doctors thought that it'd be best to go in and do it.
Folks, if you're an Ernie Irvin fan, he's going to be back. This is going to make it a little easier, hopefully, to get back in a Winston Cup car. He was here a year ago as we get set for green at Sears Point Raceway.
Several in cars. Ricky Rudd will carry one from the pole position. Ted Musgrave has a roof cam as they head for turn number 11 where Benny Parsons is. There's Jeff Bodine's roof cam on the X-Side Batteries Ford. Rusty Wallace in the Miller Genuine Draft Ford. And Mark Martin will also have a roof cam. They're moving through turn number 11 right in front of Benny Parsons. They come off of there. The pace car will go straight down the drag strip, and if the field is in proper alignment, they will get the green flag and begin racing for 74 laps in the Save Mart Supermarkets 300. Here comes the field out in front of us in the broadcast position looking for green. They get it, and we're racing at Sears Point Raceway. They come uphill about 60 feet from the lowest part of the track, uphill to turn number 2.
Clear.
Riding with Ted Musgrave. On the front bumper of the car.
See gasoline coming out of Jeff Bodine's car. Get it on our camera. Watch as the gasoline comes out the left side.
Kyle Petty got awfully loose coming off of that turn. Normally, you don't see them running side by side through the carousel and those other turns up there, but they did on the first part of this race, at least. Boy, you can see how fast they were coming by as they head into my position up here in turn seven. Everybody in single file here right now trying to feel their way around this track. David Jones gets a little high coming around the turn as they head down through the S's. Ricky Rudd, of course, the leader. Mark Martin giving a hard chase to him down towards Kenny Parsons.
And then they talked about the rocket ship. We talked about the rocket ship that Mark Martin had last week in Talladega. A lot of competitors are saying that's what he has here at Sears Point, a rocket ship, as he closes in on the back bumper of the Tide Ford of Ricky Rudd.
Rudd goes to the inside, cuts the rumble strips there in corner number 11. Here's turn number 12 right there, and now onto the main straightaway, which is very short. There's the start-finish line and headed uphill once again in turn number 1. Ricky Rudd leading the 19th road course race he has led in his 32nd event. He now has one more than Dale Earnhardt in terms of races led. We have a spin. Number 31, Ward Burton, is off course, has nosed into the tire barrier. Doesn't look like the car is hurt very much. He's trying to back it up. As soon as he gets a little clearance, he will be able to do so. Ward Burton in the Hardee's Chevrolet is just about to get going once again after spinning.
The left rear tire is flat on the car. We see the tire of the car. He's going to have an awfully hard time getting back to the pit area.
Here's a replay. There is Ward, who's right ahead of Darrell Waltrip when he lost control up at the top of the hill in turn number 2.
Bob, I believe he cut the tire, and that's what caused him to spin around, it looked like.
I agree with you wholeheartedly, Ned. You know, Ward Burton got in the tire barriers yesterday afternoon in practice, heavily damaged the car. A lot of effort was spent getting the car back there.
All right, here's Rudd continuing to lead Mark Martin. Here's a foot cam as he heads toward 11.
You see if he hit the brakes? That's turn 10, I think he's going through now. Now here he comes down turn, hard on the brakes. Third gear, second gear, first gear, wow! Going to first gear off turn 11 is Ricky Rudd.
I wonder if he wants people to tell me, or me to tell people that, huh?
Giving away his secret.
Boy, it's a ballet and a dance they do all afternoon long. Look at the footwork continuing as he goes up to turn 2. Another car is off. Looks like the 72 car of Dan Obrist, one of the Winston West drivers.
And he isn't off the racetrack far enough. If he doesn't get this car going, we will have caution flag. Car is moving. Appears to be moving.
Apparently he didn't spin or anything, just pulled the car off and stopped. He has 3 starts in Winston West competition last year, currently 4th in the Winston West standings after 1 start this year. So they're headed toward Ned once again. Ricky Rudd continuing to lead over Mark Martin and Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and Terry Labonte.
Everybody running in single file through here, Bob.
And believe it or not, Ward Burton is just now getting to pit road.
Darrell Waltrip has moved up to 14th position.
He started 17th.
And we see that Dan Obrist is sitting in the S's. We saw the flagman waving the caution flag.
And we do have a caution. An overall caution has been called for. The 31 car made a quick pit stop to change the tire, came back out. But now as the drivers come down here in front of the starter stand, they do see the yellow. And for the first time this afternoon, we reduced the speed. Dan Obrist is stalled over in the S's. That's the reason for the caution. No serious accident of any kind. Ricky Rudd continuing to lead here in the early going of the Save Mart Supermarkets 300. And ESPN Speed World coverage is being brought to you this afternoon by Chevrolet. One car company has won more races in the history of NASCAR, genuine Chevrolet. By AC Delco Automotive Parts. AC Delco, it's like buying time. By Texaco Havilland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. Take it to the star. And by NASCAR 94 Year in Review. To order, call 800-71-NASCAR. We're under caution for the first time, and we'll be back in just a moment.
Championship Series is back. Introducing the race-modified Chevrolet Monte Carlo.
When it comes to roping a steer, folks in Grand Junction, Colorado will tell you that Ron Markin can ride with the best of them. And when it comes to overhauling an engine or rebuilding a carburetor, well, he can do it all. You see, when Ron's not riding a horse for fun, he's turning a wrench for a living. So he buys a lot of parts, mostly from AutoZone. Sure, there are other parts stores in town, but Ron knows that when you want the right part for the right price, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
From Texaco Clean System 3 gasolines to Havilland Formula 3 motor oil and Texaco antifreeze coolant, there's no better place to take your car than to the star.
At Sears Point Raceway, Sonoma, California, the Save Mart Supermarkets 300 just about to go under green flag racing conditions once again. Dan Obra's car has been taken off of the racetrack, and now the pace car accelerates off. The field comes down and gets the flag, and here we go once again.
And Bob, as these cars go in turn one, believe it or not, cars are still going through turn 11. When you put these cars in single file, they're a long way around this racetrack. Watch as the cars are still down at the start-finish line, getting back up to speed.
Now you can see there on the far right of your screen how they're still down at the start-finish line and now coming uphill to turn number two. Just now, the last car comes through. The Napa field summary will show you where the entire field is running at the moment. There's Rudd and Martin, and Dale Earnhardt running in third position, about a car length and a half behind Mark Martin and closing in.
He's starting to keep in the pressure on Mark Martin. See how close he gets there as they come out of turn six now and head in towards turn seven. One of the high speed points on this racetrack, but then they really have to gear down into second gear to come around this turn. See how low Earnhardt and Rudd stay. Some of them will come in here high and then try to cut it low coming off the turn. Then they start through the S's. Now we're riding with Rusty Wallace.
Downshift to second gear. This is turn 10. He'll make that right and head straight for me in turn 11. There he is in fourth place. All the cars swing out very wide. So, and look, we see the two Hendrick cars, Jeff Gordon and Terry Labonte, side by side.
Oh, and look at Mark Martin.
Something must have happened.
Something happened to Rudd. Martin had to take evasive action then real quick because Rudd's car just seemed to almost stop as it came across the line.
Yeah, he really did. He would have run over him if he hadn't taken that action.
So Ricky Rudd leads the first five laps of this race, and then all of a sudden something happened. Jerry, what's the problem?
Well, Billy Engel standing on top of the toolbox said, Ricky just radioed and said, sounded like something just broke, something snapped in the car, possibly in the transmission. The car just quit pulling as he came out of turn 11 up the front straightaway. The car just snapped and began to slow.
So he turns over the lead to Mark Martin, who's prior to today, he's only led one lap here at Sears Point. You'll recall a few years ago, we had a frightening crash here into the tire barriers, rolled the car, but came back to finish the race. Now Earnhardt putting some pressure on him then.
Yeah, he made a look at it, took a look at the outside, but Martin had the roof covered and Earnhardt couldn't do anything about it, but he's been intimidated.
Take a look once again at what happened to Ricky Rudd as he came off of corner number 11. Things appeared to be okay, Benny, and then it just quit on him.
Yeah, Jerry Punch, anything else from down in the pit area?
Well, now that Rudd is back up to speed, they're trying to figure out what may have happened. What Ricky thinks may have happened, the car may have actually been between gears, or the car may have just jumped out of gear momentarily as he pushed the accelerator down. The car quit pulling. He put the clutch back in, put it back in gear, and the car came back up to speed. So apparently the car may have either been between gears as they were shifting up, or maybe it just jumped out of gear momentarily.
Three Rick Henry cars are running together on their, well, they're not anymore. Kyle Petty has put himself ahead of Ken Schrader. Here's a good battle. Ted Musgrave and Mike Wallace. Mike Wallace turning in a great qualifying performance, starting 10th.
And Ted Musgrave got on the inside of Mike Wallace, come down in turn 11, was able to outbreak the 90 Heiligmeyer's Ford and take that position away. Michael Waltrip in the Pennzoil Pontiac, you see right behind Mike Wallace, tried to follow him, couldn't quite make it. Ken Schrader is not really going the way that he should. Dale Jarrett just got around him, and he's very slow. There, as a matter of fact, a number of cars passing the Budweiser Chevrolet on Schrader.
Going down through turn number 6. Now on to the long straightaway that leads to where Ned is in 7.
Mark Martin has about a 2-car length lead over Dale Earnhardt coming in here this time. Couple of battles there. You see Schrader down on the inside. Car still going by him. I wonder if maybe his car's locked up in gear. And here we have a spin. Lake Speed out into the graft area. A lot of sand here, too. Once you spin off into that area, it'll slow you down very quickly.
Jerry, what now is wrong with Ken Schrader, who's dropped back several positions in the last lap?
And Bob, look for him to drop back even more. Apparently, Ken Howes, the crew chief, told me a moment ago, Kenny said the gear shift lever just snapped off in his hand. So he's out there basically without the ability to change gears very effectively. He's trying to shift gears with what's left of the lever attached to the floorboard. So that's going to make it a long day if they can't get that fixed, possibly at a caution flag or their first pit stop here as soon as possible.
Tough break for Ken Schrader, who had run so well in practice and qualifying.
And Ken Peterson has spun the 91 car, entering turn 11, and the car still sitting there. He finally gets it, restarts, and he will take off again.
One of the Winston West competitors in the race. Falls back in line. There's Dick Trickle, who went to the Bob Bondurant School of High Performance Driving to learn how to run a road course, and he didn't have much success in qualifying. We do have a full course caution again. Second one.
I expect it's because of Lake Speed, who's still sitting here in turn 7, Bob. He could not get the car refired, and he's in a very vulnerable position there. Somebody else should spin off, and a lot of them do right in that area. It could be trouble for him and them as well.
So Lake Speed is off in corner number 7, and that's brought out our second caution of the day here at Sears Point. We'll be right back.
If you settle for a remanufactured engine without a brand name, be sure you've got a pair of name brand shoes. AC Delco Engines, the national brand name with the nationwide warranty. Call for a location near you. Of course, if you come in on foot, we'll understand.
Miller Genuine Draft Rusty Wallace stock car. Awesome when opened up.
Nobody undersells Western Auto on name brands. To make sure, we price check the competition daily. We even offer an unbeatable low price guarantee. Check our serious savings on Champion spark plugs. Now just 39 cents each after rebate. America's favorite spark plug is Champion. Pay for name brands at no name prices. Get serious. Get Western Auto.
Western Auto, no stranger to these parts.
Rule number 60, hook it. Rule number 69, slow whistle. Rule number 29, gross misconduct. Rule number 25, to play the game, use a puck. The Stanley Cup playoffs continue tonight at 7:30 Eastern. The NHL rules on ESPN2.
You ride on the top of Mark Martin's car. He's right behind the pace car, the leader of the race. We are under our second caution of the day. Lake Speed spun off over in turn number 7. Well, we've seen a couple of problems already relating to transmissions. Remember, Ricky Rudd came off of the corner number 11 a few laps ago in the lead, and Dr. Jerry Punch suggesting that the car may be stuck between gears. Transmission's a very vulnerable item here at Sears Point. With more, here's a track back featuring Kyle Petty and Mr. Benny Parsons.
Track facts are brought to you by Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
This is a Jericho transmission. This is what most everybody have gone to in Winston Cup racing or stock car racing throughout the country, especially on the road courses. This is what it was designed for. It's like an old Ford top loader. It replaced the T10. What happens is that even though this thing looks tough, made out of steel, made out of aluminum, you got to treat it like a baby. You got to nurse it. You got to play with it. You got to treat it just exactly like it's your most prized possession. And you start shifting, you start going back and forth here. You get excited, you start braking, you start jamming. It hangs in gear up in this part of the transmission, not inside the case, not in the linkage. It hangs in gears down in the box here. What they have to do, they come in, they jack the cars up, they have to reach up under it with their hands or with a pair of pliers because it's really hot, and start snatching it. And they snatch these rods until they catch it and get it in between gears. These things hang in gears really, really easy. Like I say, you got to baby them, but they're pretty tough, man. You can't put a grenade inside of them and blow them up. It's the linkage that's a weak spot.
Let's take a closer look at what Kyle Petty was talking about. This is the T10 transmission used for many years. This is a synchronizer hub out of a T10. You see the very fine teeth, and that brass ring has to slide up against the gear and slow it. That's the gear that my thumb is over. Has to slow it down enough for the synchronizer ring to pop over and put the transmission in gear. There, that's how the thing goes in gear. This has been the preferred transmission for many, many years in Winston Cup racing. Several years ago, the Jericho transmission came into the forefront. Kyle Petty talked about the transmission being a top loader. That's because the gears are loaded into the transmission through the top of the transmission. And this is a synchronizer hub for a Jericho. Now, folks, this is a little bit exaggerated, but this is about how easy this baby goes in gear. T10, sometimes they use them on the oval track. All the road racers use the Jericho.
Ken Schrader is still in the pits. Remember his linkage. Bro, Jerry, what's the situation?
Bob, let me show you. As you watch Kenny Schrader, the Ken Howell's in the car working on the linkage. Now, the shifter that has been broken off, I have it in my hand here. And actually, as Schrader was shifting gears, take a look at what happened. Up through turn two, boom, just came off in his hand. He carried this back in with him, hand to the guy here. Try to replace this, if you would, please. So they're in the car, trying to replace the shifter. A tough break for Kenny Schrader, but he did not lose a lap here under caution at Sears Point. We are under caution once again at Sears Point International Raceway. The Save Mark Supermarkets 300 coming your way in just a moment. Stay with us.
Saving lives and helping the sick. There's a lot more to it than that. There's compassion and caring, a way of life at Manatee Memorial Hospital. Our dedicated physicians and staff believe that people should be cared for, not just treated. It's that philosophy that helps us provide the type of health care you expect from the community's health care leader. Special support groups, educational services, physician referrals, any health-related topic. Call the professionals at Manatee Memorial.
Alex Karras Lincoln Mercury has just received a special allocation of new cars with special discounts so we can pass those savings on to you. Like this brand new 95 Grand Marquis, fully equipped for only $19,995. Or buy this brand new Lincoln Town Car, fully equipped for only $32,995. Now this sale is good only at Alex Karras Lincoln Mercury, and we're located 2 miles north of the Sarasota-Bradenton Airport on US Highway 41. Don't miss out on this special sale.
The Mariners' year. This week, they'll have to get past Chili Davis, Lee Smith, and the California Angels. The Mariners visit the Big A. Sunday Night Baseball, tonight at 8, only on ESPN.
We are back at Sears Point, but we remain under caution. The lights on top of the pace car are out, however, and we should go going back to green here in just a moment. BP, what's up?
Hey, Jerry Punch, I need to see that shifter one more time. Have you still got that shifter?
Got it right here, Benny.
Hey, you see those holes in there? Now, folks, they put those holes in there to make that shifter just a little bit lighter, and you can see that the shifter broke in one of those holes. I bet Ken Howes and those guys are wishing right now they'd never drill those holes.
Exactly, Benny. You know, this is only part of the shifter. The whole thing, actually, is I'll show you what a hole looks like. That's what the whole thing looks like with the holes drilled in it. But some of the teams have gone to a road race shifter, like Mark Martin. Their entire shifter is that long. It's about 3 inches long. You move the entire knob an inch and a half to go from first to second or third and fourth. Less than 2 inches of movement to shift gears on a road course shifter. Let's go to John Curtin, who's standing by with Lake Speed.
Jerry, we're in the garage here. As you can see, the left rear tire, how it's pushed up. They can't even get it off. They're going to have to replace the drive shaft. Trailing's arms are bent on the car. Lake, what happened?
I'm not sure. I was just kind of taking our time. The car had run real good. You know, the Spam Melon 2 Ford was really fast just the afternoon last practice session. So I just wanted to not wreck, wait till everything settled down and be able to move on. And I was just starting to make a move there. I've been trying to get by Bill easy-like. And that time I went up in that corner, I was just going to run up on the inside of him there and I'll break him. And when I went in that corner and downshifted, it started shaking violent, and then something broke or what, it just turned swapped ends. I mean, we see everything's tore up under there now. I don't know, both trailing arms are broken, the back of the transmission's broken. I'm not sure, that's a new one on me. I never had nothing like that happen before.
Yeah, Bob, I don't think I've ever seen this happen before without a lot of damage to the rear end of the car.
Well, looks like they got an afternoon of work ahead of them to try to get Lake back in the race. Back to Jerry.
Told you they may try to make a repair on Ken Schrader's car quickly. It didn't have time to take the other part of the shifter off, so what they did, they just sort of rigged it with a pair of vice grips. He's got a pair of vice grips clamped on to the base of that broken shifter like that. He's going to shift all afternoon. I think his hand's going to get a little sore grabbing these babies all afternoon on his 2.52-mile road course. He has got his work cut out for him, Bob.
Well, you can fix anything with a rubber band, a paper clip, and now some vice grips. Kenny Schrader is back in the race. Yes?
I thought they taught us that in the South. I didn't know they taught that in South Africa how to do something like that.
Yeah, Ken Howes is the crew chief on that car and is from the country of South Africa. Well, they didn't go green. They will, however, next time by. We'll take a break in the meantime.
In Normal, Illinois, Gene Goble is popular with folks who need their car fixed. He does good work, and he doesn't charge an arm and a leg. Because when he needs auto parts, Gene buys a lot of them at AutoZone. You see, the prices are low every day at AutoZone. So a lot of good mechanics like Gene just pass the savings on to their customers. Plus, they can still get the best quality parts. Sure, they know how to do the work right, but they also know how to save money doing it at AutoZone.
Most trackers can follow the trail only as long as the weather holds up. Unless it's a tracker spurred on with genuine AC spark plugs. AC plugs fire faster than lightning for performance so smooth, even the thunder claps. And that'll keep your engine on the trail to a longer life.
Call 1-800-AC-DELCO. It's like buying time.
So better track down some AC spark plugs.
Thank you.
after Sunday, we believe in putting on our best. Maybe that's why no car company has won more races in the history of NASCAR than Chevrolet.
How light is the new Feather Life gas trimmer from Weed Eater? Well, at up to 33% less than the nearest competitor, it's the world's lightest. How easy to start is the new Weed Eater Feather Life gas trimmer? Well, it doesn't take a lot of pull to get all the power you'll ever need. How well does the new Weed Eater Feather Light trim grass? The world's lightest gas-powered trimmer performs like a heavyweight.
We've done a lot of traveling the last few weeks. It's a long way by airplane out here, but think of what the truck drivers went through. 2,825 miles from Talladega out here. It took them 2 days and 28 minutes. Now, if we were to have ridden in one of the race cars at race speeds, considering the pole speed of Talladega, it would have taken only 16 hours and 2 minutes. We are about to go green once again at Sears Point with Mark Martin up front. He is no stranger to leading on road courses. As a matter of fact, Mark led the most laps and miles on road courses in 1994, and he has the best average finish of all drivers this year, despite the fact he's third in the point standings. His average finish this year has been 9.0 compared to Dale Earnhardt's 9.8. Racing once again.
I get the impression that Earnhardt wants this lead awfully bad. As we see Dale Jarrett hung up on the outside for just an instant.
Yeah, he wants to get up there and lead a lap so he can get 5 bonus points.
You can look for your favorite driver there and see where he is running on the track if you're familiar with the color of his car. One impressive run in the early going here has been Bobby Labonte. He had to take a provisional to get in the race. He started in 38th position, and now he is running in 28th. He's picked up 10 positions in the first 10 laps.
And that's pretty impressive, Bob, on a road course where it's very difficult to pass. As the cars go through turn 7 here now, Bobby comes into the turn here trying to make another pass up on the outside of the car 09 of Terry Fisher. Good quite make the pass that time, though.
Let's see if he can do it through the S's. This is not an opportunity to pass here because you're going left, right, left, right. After they clear turn number 10 and start down this straightaway and then into 11, Benny, is where he could pass.
It's certainly where he can pass, and he will be trying to pass as we see Kyle Petty on the inside of Terry Labonte taking that spot away. Now Jeff Bodine will try to follow, but it doesn't look like Bodine was able to do that. And we've got Fisher, heavy smoke out of the right front tire on his car as he enters turn 11.
There is Randy LaJoy racing behind Bobby Hamilton. And also there is the 45 car. That is Wally Dallenbach in his first race in 1995.
And what did he finish, fourth out here last year?
Yeah, this is a one-race deal, but Wally says he'll be in Indianapolis for the Brickyard 400, and if things go well, they'll have other opportunities to race. The 09 car is stopped. That's the 09 Terry Fisher machine, one of the Winston West drivers that Benny indicated was smoking pretty heavily as he went through turn number 11. Well, he's made it all the way to turn between turns 2 and 3 and isn't going very much.
Leaders now headed through turn 7. Now Rusty Wallace putting pressure on Earnhardt as Mark Martin has got himself a little bit of a lead. But Wallace wanting to get by Earnhardt. But he can't do it down through these S's. This is a tough place to pass, as you said a moment ago, Bob. But at the end of these S's, that's where they can do it, if they can outbreak somebody going in there where Benny Parsons is.
You know, it's no wonder they break off the lever, Benny. Did you see how Rusty slammed that thing up into gear?
I'm telling you, unbelievable just how much force they put on that shifting lever. And you can see how long that the lever is on Rusty's car. So you can imagine how strong a piece it has to be. There Rusty goes to fourth gear. Turn 1. Left-hander. Starts up the hill, third gear, back to second gear.
There's a 25 car of Ken Schrader. He's working pretty well with those vice grips, huh?
Looks like he's working pretty well. He's just been able to get by Bobby Labonte in the Interstate Battery Chevrolet. But he probably changed tires while he was in there, and four fresh tires might be an advantage here at this road course.
You know, a lot of people criticize road racing. They say that these cars need to be on ovals, but I tell you, this brings a whole new dimension to a driver's performance. I love these road races. They're always pretty exciting, and it does call upon a driver to have an extra ability other than just turning left all the time.
Watch as he makes turn 11 there. Going in turn 11, he gets on the inside of Labonte, outbrakes him, and goes in right behind Kenny Peterson, the 91 car.
So Ken Schrader moves up to 34th position now. He dropped back, I believe, to 41st, but has passed several cars in the last few laps.
And he's still passing cars, Ken. He's getting through the turns very well, so apparently that transmission is, or the lever on the transmission is working okay for him, because he's going as good as he did before.
Schrader trying to make another pass, BP.
Yeah, he's on the inside of Dave Marcus in the Olive Garden car. And there we see Labonte on the inside of Peterson, trying to take that spot away. He does. And you're right, watching these cars go around this road course is so much fun. And let me tell you, Bob, these drivers are having as much fun driving on this road course. It is the most fun you'll ever have in a race car.
Well, Earnhardt now is beginning to put a little bit more pressure on Mark Martin. He closes up in the corners, Ned.
Yeah, just a lap or so ago, Martin had begun to pull away, and Rusty Wallace was up there challenging Earnhardt. But now that situation is reversed. Earnhardt has pulled away from Wallace, and as he comes into turn seven here, he moves in closer to Mark Martin.
Rusty Wallace is running third. Jeff Gordon is fourth. Kyle Petty is fifth, Terry Labonte is sixth. In seventh position is Jeff Bodine. Eighth is Dale Jarrett. Ninth is Ricky Rudd. And tenth is Ted Musgrave. And ready, isn't he?
He sure is. He's trying his best to get on the inside of Mark Martin. Can't make it.
Mark Martin could sure shuffle the point standings if he wins here today. He's only 9 points out of the lead. Of course, Earnhardt and Gordon are tied going in. We'll take a look at the top 15 here. You're watching the 26 car driven by Hutch Strickland, who is doing pretty well. He's 14th at the moment. Now looking back on Earnhardt, as he again closes in on Mark. There are the top 15 for you. 59 laps to go. 74 is the distance of this race. We'll take a break and be back with more live coverage from Sonoma, California.
The Stacy's Way is an incredible buffet for the whole family. Our 60-plus cards earn you an even lower one price, and our healthy variety of over 100 items gets you out of the kitchen more often. So what is it you like most at Stacy's?
Come taste the delight, the variety's so right. The special buffet is Stacy's. Best we love you, day is Stacy's.
Uh-oh, it's tinkle time. I gotta go.
Not again. You just went.
You make it sound like I've got a choice.
Loss of bladder control is not a normal part of aging.
Harry said Bernice had the same problem and she's dry now. No surgery, no expensive pads.
You told Harry? Now the whole world knows.
Millions of Americans suffer needlessly.
I'd rather have your problem.
You think constipation is easy? It's hard times.
Well, what are we going to do?
Over 150 doctors send patients to the AMS Freedom Center. For a free seminar, call 755-1200.
New Zealand's in the lead for the America's Cup. Can Dennis Conner steal the wind and sail to victory?
When we're behind in the race, we would try to attack and hope the other team would make a mistake.
New Zealand plans to zig to their zag and take the cup home.
In your head, you force the opposition the wrong way so that you can increase your lead.
Who will steal the wind and rule the sea? The race continues tomorrow at 4 on ESPN.
Sunday Night Baseball is out here in California tonight, down in Anaheim Stadium. Ken Griffey Jr. and the Seattle Mariners take on Chili Davis and the California Angels. That's at 7:56 Eastern Time tonight here on ESPN Major League Baseball, Sunday Night Style. Here we got four cars running right together on the racetrack. That's Bill Elliott,
Bud Strickland, Derek Cope, and Sterling Marlin.
Thank you. Marlin now going to try to pass Cope.
Cope trying to pass Strickland. Now Marlin gets down on the inside. But boy, it is slick down there, Bob. This turn is getting slick. We're seeing cars get sideways. A lot of them as they come off of turn seven.
Bill Elliott was able to get by Hutch Strickland just a lap ago and now putting a few car lengths on the Quaker State Ford.
This is 14th, 15th, 16th, and 17th.
Check right behind them there, behind the four car of Sterling Marlin, having a good run here today. And Joe's had his problems here this week. He got in trouble on Friday during practice, banged up the front end of his car going into turn 11 down there, and then got into the wall again, into the tire wall, had to put another nose on it, but it's still going good.
And John Kernan has more on Joe Nemechek's run.
Well, Dan, I was just talking to Joe this morning about that. They said to knock the nose off. It was a brand new race car that they brought out here. They had a lot of confidence in the car and in also Joe's ability. But he says with his lack of experience out here on Sears Point, you got to be really careful, because if you just get one wheel just a little bit off the track, as he found out on Friday, you are history.
And right behind him, some pretty good racing going on.
I would see Jeff Burton, the 75 car of Todd Bodine, and John Andretti. There goes Brett Bodine, the Lowe's hardware car. And there's Bobby Hamilton, closed up on the back bumper of John Andretti, going towards Ned Jarrett.
This is a place that some of them have been able to make a pass coming into this turn. There's Marlin up on the outside of Derek Coach, and that's not going to work either. Boy, they are doing some hard racing in this group.
They are doing some awfully hard racing, Ned, but the leader is getting away from them. Jerry Cope wants to get by that 26 car because he feels like he can run a little bit faster. Right now, Mark Martin driving away. As they come towards me in turn 11, and Jerry Cope gets on the inside, tries his best to outbreak the 26 car. A little bit of contact. Up the hill goes Hunt Strickland, and Derek Cope has that spot.
Oh.
Now Sterling Marlin's going to try it, but Joe Nemechek trying to pass Marlin. And the 26 car comes back.
Well, they go through turn two side by side.
And that can't last long. Now Strickland gets back up in front.
And Marlin had to get on the brakes, runs up on the rumble strips.
And I see Bobby, Randy LaJoy, very, very slow coming between turns 10 and 11. There he is. I think maybe he'll make the pit road. At least he's going to be off the racetrack where it's fairly safe.
He was running 23rd, and all of a sudden it quit running on him.
Now, back to the real race at hand.
Strickland, Cope, and Marlin.
Ned, there's probably going to be a lot of passing come to you this time. Uh-oh.
And here's some real battle going on. Jeff Gordon has moved up on Rusty Wallace, and he has been beating on his bumper. Well, almost. He has been running very, very close to him for several laps, trying his best to get around him.
And right behind them is another good battle as well. It's Kyle Petty and Terry Labonte have moved up on Kyle when they came through seven the last time. They were trying to pass it. Wow, did that truck pull out in front of those race cars?
It started to, Ned. I thought he was going across the racetrack right in front of Mark Martin. The wrecker was going out to push Randy LaJoy, who in fact has stalled at the entrance to pit road, and now they're trying to get the truck off the racetrack.
Yeah, I hope so.
Well, in all that, Gordon lost a little bit of momentum and has dropped back to car length or two, but now once again closes in on Rusty Wallace. This is, again, the battle for third place. Jeff running fourth. Oh, and Nemechek and Strickland are side by side.
Strickland holds on to the position. Of course, Derek Cope and Sterling Marlin were able to get around Huck somewhere since we last saw them.
As we watch this, I will tell you that the wrecker now has gone across the racetrack, is going to push LaJoy into the pit area, so he will be out of harm's way.
There's LaJoy being pushed into the pit area.
And here Jeff Gordon is on the outside. Well, as we watch that coming in, but Jeff Gordon got on the outside of Rusty Wallace. They get together as they came off of turn seven, but Wallace held the position. And you see how far back Jeff dropped. They were side by side when they went through turn seven. And when they came off of there, they bumped. And Jeff lost some position, lost some space.
Definitely did lose some momentum. As a matter of fact, Kyle Petty now is knocking on his rear spoiler.
Okay, here's what we're talking about. Gordon was up on the outside, and then they come off of the turn. Gordon had got a little bit too far outside. They got together. Away Rusty goes.
He either had to get hard on the brakes or he was going to the grass, and he chose the right option.
Yeah.
And that time, Kyle Petty tried to get on the inside of Jeff Gordon going in turn 11. So Kyle Petty, the Coors Light car.
He's having a great run here, Ben.
He is having a great run. He's getting all excited for the motorcycle run starting tomorrow morning.
Going to make a whole bunch of money for charitable organizations as they ride cross-country on their Harleys. Here's Kyle Petty running fifth. Mark Martin continues to be your leader. Earnhardt is second, Rusty Wallace third, then Jeff Gordon and Kyle Petty. And we do expect the first scheduled round of pit stops before too long. We'll be back for those in just a moment.
Texaco Clean System 3 gasolines to Havoline Formula 3 motor oil and Texaco antifreeze coolant, there's no better place to take your car than to the Star.
Got to treat it real good. Ooh, you got to treat it so fine. Put the pedal to the metal, mile after mile. Keep it humming all the time. Add more life to your car. Take it to the Star.
Nobody undersells Western Auto on name brands. To make sure, we price check the competition daily. We even offer an unbeatable low price guarantee. Check our serious savings on Champion spark plugs. Now just 39 cents each after rebate. America's favorite spark plug is Champion. Hey, for name brands at no name prices, get serious. Get Western Auto.
Western Auto, no stranger.
During the playoffs, I take every opportunity to work on my game. I work on my passing, my shooting, and especially my body checking.
Mark Martin leads the Save Mart Supermarkets 300 here at Sears Point Raceway in California. We have completed 21 out of 74 laps. Here comes second place Dale Earnhardt. Here is third place Wallace, but look who's in fourth now. Kyle Petty has passed Jeff Gordon and drops Gordon back to fifth position, and here's how Kyle did it.
Goes up in turn two on the inside, gets position, takes the spot away.
Kyle's car really working good now. He moves up and he's going to challenge Rusty Wallace here.
Kyle's car is working awfully well.
There's the 33 car Presley off. Is that right in front of you,
yeah,
Ed?
Right in front of me. He gets her going again. He just came in here. It looked like a little bit too wide, a little bit too hard. Went off into the sand and grass.
Throw any dirt up in your face there,
yeah,
when he took
a little
off?
Bit, yeah. I need goggles out here.
And Nemechek and Schrader are racing together. There's John Andretti also there and Todd Bodine.
And the 87 car of Nemechek has picked up some type of oil leak. It gets some smoke as he comes off turn 11.
We'll take a look at what happened to Robert Presley, one of the rookie drivers coming in here. See, he gets a little bit high there, and I think maybe he might have locked the brakes out into the sand, picked up the dirt. He gets it fired away and keeps going.
Todd Bodine trying to get by Nemechek now.
Schrader's up to 20th. Bodine and Nemechek running for position.
Kyle Petty past Rusty Wallace coming into turn 7.
And now Gordon comes up on Rusty Wallace. Wallace again has moved to third place, has dropped back to fourth place as Kyle Petty has passed him.
Boy, it seems like the longer that 42 car runs, the faster he goes, Bob. And here's how he did it. Coming into turn 7, he just ran right up on Rusty and made the pass and drove away. And I understand Rusty's headed for the pits.
He just went by me, Ned, going towards the pit. Evidently, he's either stopping short or needs a chassis adjustment on that Miller Genuine Draft Ford. In-car cameras show he's slow, slow.
While he comes to pit, we might mention that Darrell Walter took his car into the garage area a little while ago.
And Jerry punches there.
And it will make a routine stop change. All four tires on Rusty Wallace's car. Some sheet metal having been rubbed in the left rear as they already have changed the right side tires. They had a problem with the right front getting the lug nuts back on. Billy Wilburn got them on. Now they come around to the left front. That cost them about a second and a half, 2 seconds. And Rusty is out and away. They made no chassis adjustment whatsoever on the Miller Genuine Draft Ford.
Trying to get back up to speed.
Yep. And this could be somewhat of a strategy move. You come in early before the other leaders come in, and then hope after you go back out that a caution comes out. That way everybody else has to hit under the caution. You'd be leading the race then. Harry?
Yeah, that's exactly what's going on here. When everyone saw Rusty come in, he pitted short. It's called by coming in early. You pit short, and everyone else comes in behind you. You got to be the leader. So, unlike an oval track where you want a caution to come out and possibly pit under caution, as Kyle Petty went off the track. They are calling Kyle in, by the way. I'm standing in their pits, and Barry Dodson said, hey, Rusty's already pitted short. It's our turn to come in next. We don't want to pit late here and be at the back of that long line with traffic so tough here at Sears Point, Bob.
Kyle, what happened up there in front of you with Kyle?
Okay, this is Ned up here in turn 7. Kyle just came in here. Well, take a look. He got in there a little bit too hard, got off into the grass and the sand. I pointed this out to Kyle when he's going around and the convertible's being introduced this morning. I pointed to this area and I said, you don't want to be here. Well, he got off in here and now he's in the pits. He and Dale Jarrett both.
Right. Here they come down. Jeff Bodine has also stopped. Routine pit stops going on here. Kyle is right there with Jerry Punch.
And Bob, Kyle locked the brakes up and slid about 4 or 5 feet into his pit, and he tosses the water bottle out the right side window. This is probably a strategy move, and Barry Dodson told me they would possibly pit early. Sterling Morgan is in, and John Kernan is there.
Marlin, no chassis adjustment. A four-tire change is Sterling Marlin. As they drop the jack, he is down and away. No chassis adjustment. We expect Bill Elliott to be in shortly.
Here we see Jeff Bodine and
Sterling Marlin trying to race off pit road. They get on the racetrack now, back up to full speed.
Well, Jeff Bodine lost quite a bit of time there compared to Kyle Petty and Dale Jarrett on that pit stop. He was running in front of Jarrett, right behind Kyle. In fact, he got in front of Kyle when Kyle got off the track up here, so he's going to be several seconds behind both of those, so he had an extended stop.
Nima Check and Bobby Labonte running for position. They're back at about 18th spot. Here comes Dale Earnhardt into the pits.
And also Jeff Gordon's going to follow him. Terry Labonte, Ricky Rudd, Ted Musgrave, Michael Waltrip. Our leader, Mark Martin, stays on the racetrack. But everyone is headed toward pit road. Here comes Bill Elliott. As we're watching, Dale Earnhardt head for his pit where Jerry Punch is.
And we might add, they're not going to see Mark Martin for at least two more laps, we are told, as Earnhardt brings his car at 35 miles an hour down to a stop. They will change all four tires. But what happened to you guys? Second, third, fourth, and fifth. Knew they couldn't catch Martin, so why get further behind by waiting too late to pit? That's why they come in early. And Bill Elliott is also pitting as John Kernan is there.
Once again, Jerry, a four tire change. Gasoline, right side's already done as the Hardy boys go to work. The left side's now coming off, going on. Dale Earnhardt leaves pit road. Bill Elliott still sitting here. Also, Jeff Gordon has made his stop and is gone. And now Jerry Labonte is down in the way as Bill Elliott leaves.
Quite crowded coming out. There's Labonte, Rudd, and Musgrave. Here comes Michael Waltrip out of the pits. There is Bill Elliott. But Mark Martin has not come in for his first pit stop yet. He's coming up through the S's here, turns 8, 8, 8, 9, and 10.
We'll see this time if he decides to come towards the pits. That's turn 10. He makes that right-hand corner. Head toward turn 11 and pit road. Let's see, is he going to turn left or right?
Yep.
Stays right.
Yep.
Well, I'm sure they know exactly how far they can go on the back of fuel, but Benny, this is one racetrack you do not want to run out of fuel on unless you just happen to head towards where you are there. Because if you run out of here where I'm at, you can't coast back down through there.
Or especially right there. If you run out of fuel right there, you're dead in the water. You got to wait for the caution flag.
Yeah, no question.
And, you know, last week at Talladega, these cars will run 60 laps, some of them. That's a 2.66-mile racetrack. Here it's a 2.52-mile racetrack, and they can run probably 27, 28 laps, about half the fuel mileage they get at Talladega.
Jerry, what's the strategy here with Mark?
First of all, let me comment on what Benny said. Mark Martin could go actually 29, maybe even 30 laps if he had to on fuel. That's what Steve Mill calculated this morning was telling me. The reason it didn't fit, Mark said, sir, Mark and Steve talked about it on the radio, and Steve said, we feel like we've got it on road right now. We've got the best race car out there, so why panic and worry about our fuel mileage later on? We'll go ahead and stay out at pit on lap 26, and they'll be coming in next time by for four tires. Let's go to John Kernan.
Jerry, Joe Nemechek is in also for a four-tire change. Remember, we've seen some smoke. Talking with the crew, they think that possibly one of the brake ducts might be laying over and touching the rotor, getting hot and smoking. That's what they've got their fingers crossed. Didn't see any smoke. You see him came in here for work. They get the four-tire change in 21.7 seconds. Didn't see any smoke as he braked to come in here, but they're hoping that it's just that minor problem and not something serious.
Let's see if Martin does come in this time around, if he stays lit. Yes, he is. Mark Martin making his first pit stop of the day. Staying under the speed limit down pit road,
which is 35 miles an hour.
Boy, it seems like it's 5 miles an hour.
Yeah, you think it to you. How about Mark Martin? He feels like it's 2 miles an hour. Forever it takes to get to his pits, but he finally makes it there.
Jerry is there.
And they will change all four cars in a moment ago. They're talking about putting a round of bite in the car. Into one more round of bite. Apparently they decided not to do that as of yet. They have not gone back with the Rich and tried to add any more weight in the rear of the car. Left side tires are on. Great pit stop by Steve Mill and company as Mark Martin is down and away.
The 19.6 second pit stop. The yellow flag is out, and Joe Nemechek, who we just saw leave the pits moments ago, is into the tires and has crashed pretty heavily here. We see him moving around.
How did he get in that kind of position?
Man.
He's on the wrong side of the tire, isn't he?
Well, sure looks like it, yeah.
Yeah, he sure is.
Man, let's see. Maybe we can tell how he got in that position. Oh, I see how he got in that position.
He just drove over the tires, didn't
he? Man.
John Kernan, what do you know?
Bob, I just talked to his crew. They're headed back. They're busy now, running back to the garage area. Mike Borsinger to get the car fixed when Joe can get it in, when he can get it in. What Joe told them on the radio was, it just didn't stick when I went into the turn. That's all he had to say.
Well, it sure didn't. It flew up the hill, over the tire wall, and now there he is. This is the second incident of the weekend for Joe Nemechek. Again, he appears to be okay. Benny?
You know, here's the leader, I guess. Ken Schrader is probably leading the race because he hasn't stopped yet. He hasn't stopped on his caution flag on the green flag. He stopped earlier. But that's the bad news, because when he does stop and change the tires, all the other guys are going to stay on the racetrack. He'll go all the way back to the end of the line, won't he, man?
Yes, he will. And Mark Martin was very fortunate that he was able to make that pit stop under green and get back out just as the caution came, because it helped him to... That way he won't have to stop under caution. Now, Schrader's going to get the lead a lap here, and the pit road is closed anyway, so, yeah, you're right. He'll have to go to the tail end of the line.
Third caution of the day here in Sonoma. Joe Nemechek crashes up at turn number two. He's okay. We'll be right back.
Seems I've got to have a chance to see you. Every night I have the strength that's due.
Cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft. The cold one. You know the beer, you know the taste. With Miller Genuine Draft, the world's a very cool place.
A safari rarely lasts longer than a few weeks, unless it's a safari maintained with genuine AC oil filters. Because over hill, dale, and wadi, no other filter can track down, trap, and capture more dirt. So, AC oil filters keep your engine in the hunt for a longer life.
Call 1-800-AC-DELCO. It's like buying time.
When it's a matter of survival, it's AC filters.
In a sport where nerves are made of steel, it's only natural the tools are made by craftsmen. 1,600 Craftsman hand tools made in America, guaranteed forever. The only official tools of IndyCar, NASCAR, NHRA, and the new Super Truck Series by Craftsman. Only at Sears.
Monroe developed Sensitrac shocks to smooth out the road for a comfortable ride. But Sensitrac doesn't stop there. It's the only shock that also gives you extra control when you need it most. Sensitrac shocks and struts, only by Monroe. For comfort and control. Get Sensitrac shocks. Call 1-800-STRUT now for a Monroe ride expert near you.
ESPN Speed World from Sonoma, California, being brought to you by Monroe Shocks and Struts. Make the road a safer place with Monroe. By McDonald's, have you had your break today? And by Kellogg's. Kellogg's Corn Flakes is proud to sponsor NASCAR champion Terry Labonte. Joe Nemechek has crashed here at Sonoma. He is in good shape, however. We're waiting for his car to be off the track before we go green. Here's John Kernan.
You know, Bob, I was watching some of the guys. I saw Darrell Waltrip working his way through the pack, and it looked like he was going to have a great run, but Darrell is now back in the garage area with a broken transmission.
Yeah, you know, there's probably 50 pieces in a Jericho transmission, something like that. I got one right now. It's got about 1,000 pieces in it. It just blew all apart. I had no warning. It just kind of flew apart on us, and it just surprised us. So, I have that kind of luck here. I don't know, maybe I'm too hard on them or something. But anyway, the Western Auto car is out of the race, and the guys are trying to fix it, and we'll get it in there if we can.
They're going to try and work on it here. The transmission here, shifter out on pit road. Let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch.
And this caution might have been a break for Kenny Schrader's Budweiser Chevy. He just took the biceps off himself, and they're in the car, putting another shifter handle on the car. He went from last to leading with a pair of vice grips holding the transmission shifter valves together. I mean, incredible job by Kenny Schrader. By the way, as you watch him work on Schrader's car, remember, they're dedicating this race to Papa Joe Hendrick, who underwent quadruple bypass surgery in Charlotte on Wednesday this week. Papa Joe is watching, we are told, ready to go home from the hospital. They would dearly love to be able to possibly take this car to victory lane for Papa Joe.
Papa Joe is in a regular room. He's talking, joking, and complaining about the food. So we're glad that he's doing well. That lap, the lap, of course, is going to be much longer because they're under caution, allowing this work to be done.
Yeah, I mean, the lap probably takes, three, 4 minutes around your neck?
Yeah, 3.5, 4 minutes. So that gives them a lot of time to work inside. In fact, the leaders are just now up in turn three. I don't even see them. Well, I can see them up in turn three, but they're a long way from these. So they still got a lot of time to work on this car.
And they're trying to put a new shifter in there so that Schrader can shift the thing properly. I mean, shifting with the vice grips is okay, but it's rather difficult.
I would think so. Ken Schrader was running so well, so obviously when they get this problem fixed, he's going to be running okay again, but it is taking quite a bit of time. We're going to take a break here. By the way, while all of this has gone on, Mark Martin has moved back into the lead, with Dale Earnhardt running in second position, then Rusty Wallace, Kyle Petty, and Jeff Gordon. They're still trying to get Joe Nemechek's car on the right side of the tire barrier and off of the racetrack. Caution waving for the third time. Back in just a moment.
Girl, I was sitting there with Rhonda playing the Monopoly game at McDonald's. It's easy when you buy large or medium drinks, supersized fries, or hash browns. Just pull off the tab and check out the back. Can't you see yourself winning instant prizes like delicious food, a Jeep Cherokee, $1 million? And you can win instantly. Or collect a Monopoly to win, and guess what? Girl, I won! Mickey D's in the house!
Play the Monopoly game at McDonald's, because with over 50 million prizes, the next winner could be you.
Have you had your break today?
What, is this your idea of excitement? Let me tell you about exciting, okay? Driving around a racetrack at over 200 miles an hour, that's exciting. These are just flakes.
Well, what do you think?
These are really good. They're crispy, too.
Really?
Yeah, they're mighty good even with nothing on them. What are they?
Hey, Charlie.
Yeah.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes?
How could I be so dumb?
You got 500 miles to think about it.
Kellogg's is proud to sponsor NASCAR champion Terry Labonte.
You know, at AutoZone, we know our customers work just as hard as we do. So we're open when they need us, at night and on Sundays. And since 2 million folks each week count on AutoZone for what they need, when they need it, we're not about to let them down. That's why we carry so many parts and why we price them so low every day. You see, selling top quality parts at low prices every day is how we make a living. But helping customers, well, that's how we make friends.
Back at Sears Point, Ken Schrader pulls out onto the racetrack. They're still trying to get Joe Nemechek's crashed car off the track, and we're riding with Mark Martin. There's the work being done up in turn number two, where Joe Nemechek crashed. Well, all during this past week, they've been talking about the great race last week in Talladega. When we got here, they were still talking about how great the event was. And as a result of what happened last week, the NASCAR Winston Cup point standings have really been shuffled. Let's go back and take a look at the highlights from last Sunday.
Jeff Gordon head for the pit by himself.
Oh, probably didn't have any choice.
No, he didn't. Sterling Marlin is sitting on pit road waiting for Jeff Gordon to finish his pit. Believe it or not, Sterling Marlin is catching Jeff Gordon. You think he's waiting for him?
I think he is.
Can Rusty go the rest of the way?
Oh.
Only 11 more laps. Rusty Wallace is out of fuel, coming off the second corner.
We have a crash off of turn four. It's Terry Labonte.
Now, as soon as the four car gets there, down to the straightaway, I think you'll get up to the six car. You should move over and let these guys race. There he comes.
Look
down.
At that.
Let him go.
No, he's... Yep, moves out of the way. He does.
Boy, he should be given some kind of an award.
Oh, and Marky gets the car out of shape. He and Earnhardt almost get together.
comes down now to a battle between Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon off of corner number four. Jeff Gordon looks to the inside as they come to the tri-oval. Mark Martin will lead them down, however, he's got the advantage. And there's the checkered flag. Mark Martin wins the Winston Select 500. And as a result, here are the point standings before this race began. Jeff Gordon and Dale Earnhardt tied. Mark Martin only 9 out of first place. Sterling Marlin and Rusty Wallace, 6 of the top 10 at Talladega, had their best 1995 finishes. Ted Musgrave is tied with Rusty Wallace for 5th position. And there are the other 10. Great race last week at Talladega. Here's Dr. Jerry Punch.
Guys, let me show you what Kenny Schrader was dealing with for the last 18 laps. He pitted on lap 10 with a broken shifter. This is what he was using here to shift gears for 12 turns on a very demanding road course. What was left of the shifter, this little 2.5-inch piece right here, and a pair of vice grips. You want to save money, road racers? A shifter costs $50. Vice grips are $12. You can save a lot of money there because it worked awfully well for Kenny Schrader for about 18 laps, Bob.
That is absolutely amazing, but they apparently have the work done on the car. He's falling back in line, and let's try to reach him on the radio. Ken Schrader, this is Bob Jenkins at ESPN. You read me?
Yeah, ma'am.
Well, did you get your shifter fixed there during this caution?
Yeah, got rid of my bike grip. Just finished tightening up right now.
That must be pretty difficult to shift using the vice grips on this track, huh?
No, it was okay. They were bike grip brand. They held good.
We'll let them get back to racing here as they move into turn number 7, just not too far from a restart of this race. We'll see if Kenny performs as well as he did with the vice grips. Let's go to John Kernan.
Well, Joe Niemicek has finally made it back here to the garage area. And Joe, a wild ride. What happened to you?
Well, I think it's the cold tire culprit. I thought I was going slow enough in the corners. We just put on 4 new tires and went in the corner, slowed down, then all of a sudden the car just kept going straight. Had the wheels cut all the way to the right, but it kept going straight. And once you hit those tires, they're like little gremlins. They come out and bite you and set the car up in the air pretty good. But I don't think it hurt any suspension. It just folded the nose back under. We've been having the Burger King Monte Carlo's been having a rough week this week. This is the third nose they put on there, so I'm trying my best. I think I'm just trying a little bit too hard.
Might say a whopper of a weekend for these guys, Bob.
Okay, here they are in turn 11, Benny, and we're ready to go back to racing.
Sure are. Pace car pulling away from the guys. Mark Martin will lead Earnhardt down for the start-finish line and the green flag. We showed just a moment ago that Mark Martin is only 9 points behind Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon. Well, right now, if he continues on, he's only 4 points behind because he's led a lap. Earnhardt has not.
And folks, let's make the point that restarts on a road course are single file. As you saw, that's exactly where the way they started. That's where they'll start every time on caution.
Riding with Rusty Wallace, third place.
Going downhill towards turn 5. To make that right hand to 5 and go up to turn 6 or the carousel. Over that hill and that left-hander.
Then they come out of that left-hander and hit up towards turn 7. Really cranking it on when they come up through here. Mark Martin got himself a little bit of a lead there as he went through those turns. Comes into turn 7 very hard. Rusty Wallace right on the back bumper of Dale Earnhardt. See that white car there? He's a lap down, apparently, or at least a lap down. So some of the cars are trying to get by him as they went through here and through this.
Mark opening up a little bit of daylight between himself and second place Earnhardt. This is the suspension cam on Ted Musgrave's car.
Yeah, those looks like the right rear. That's the right rear or left rear? Yeah, the right rear on Musgrave's car. We can see the brake rotor, the air ducts going to the brakes, trying to keep them cooled off.
Keeping the brakes cool on the road course is very important because you use a lot of brakes here. You can see how that suspension works. Getting the right jumper over to minimize that jumping up and down is very important here as well. And you see that little chain between the shock absorber and the brake node? That chain is to pull the tire off the ground when they make a pit stop. Otherwise, they would have to, the shock would have to do it. The tire would keep going down, down, and it would take a lot longer for that to change the tire. So they use a chain to jerk the tire off the ground. You got to be careful that that chain isn't too tight, because sometimes when they hit a bump, chain's too tight, it will jerk the wheel off the ground.
And they think of putting those sponsored decals everywhere, don't they?
Yeah, that's a family kind of decal right there. How about that?
If there's a camera somewhere, not too far away will be a sticker.
You
by the way,
just how much travel they get in that car. The thing must be going up and down four or five inches.
Kyle Petty almost did it again here. Boy, he came into this turn awfully fast, but he held on.
Kyle is really giving that car a ride. He's in fourth position. Make that fifth. And Ted Musgrave, that we watched a few laps ago, was in 19th.
Let's watch Kyle as he comes into this turn. See, there's front. He just got in there too hard. Locked the right front brake. Jeff Gordon got by him. Dale Jarrett got on the inside of him, but Kyle got her right and hit it on out. Maintained fifth position. He was running fourth.
Yeah, I saw the right front on Kyle's car smoke going down to turn 11 that time, like he locked up the brakes just a little bit. There's their pole sitter, Ricky Rudd.
He's running eighth. We'll show you the top 15. As Mark Martin is looking for two wins in a row in NASCAR Winston Cup competition. We'll be right back.
Come on, pick it up. It's the playoffs. You got to put some heart in it. Let's go. All the other teams are turning up, and that's all we got to turn up. It's a whole new season now. You got to be a chip to cover these guys. I expect more out of you now. Move!
Nobody covers the playoffs like TNT. With over 30 games in 30 nights, expert analysis, and live bonus coverage of other matchups. So when it comes to postseason intensity,
nobody knows the playoffs like TNT.
The first annual Celebrity Casino and Auction will be held at the Manatee Civic Center on Saturday, May 13th from 7 to 11:30 p.m. to benefit the Manatee County Nursery School, a not-for-profit United Way agency celebrating their 60th year of service to low-income families in Manatee County. Cocktail attire is suggested to enjoy free hors d'oeuvres and a cash bar. Advance tickets are available for $15 per person and $25 per couple. For further information, call 746-3503. That's the first annual Celebrity Casino and Auction at the Manatee Civic Center, a sure bet.
The world changes. Ice becomes concrete. Water becomes sky. And endurance becomes survival. World-class competition becomes extreme as athletes come together in Rhode Island to acknowledge the brave new world of extreme sports. The Extreme Games on ESPN and ESPN2 begins June 24th. The world as you know it has changed.
It's the St. Mark's Supermarkets 300 from Sears Point Raceway in Sonoma, California. NASCAR Winston Cup Racing. We're watching from the leader, Mark Martin's car, back to second place, Dale Earnhardt. Here's a mess of cars. Hut Strickland,
hey,
Sean Andretti. Yep.
Hey, they look good now. You should have seen these cars when they came by me a few minutes ago. They were absolutely four abreast as it exited turn four.
Brett Bodine is also there. Let's see.
Watch this.
Hey, made it work.
Made it work.
How about that? It's about 18th, 19th, 20th, 21st. Oh, my goodness, they were in all over the place.
Now watch this minute ago. I mean, the 26th car gets on the inside. That's Strickland. He gets on the inside of Hut Strickland, and he runs into the 12 while he's doing it because we got Terry Fisher out there. Now, the 37 comes off a little wide. The 11 car on the inside of the 26 and the 90 on the inside of the 11. Did I lie to you?
They were four abreast coming off the corner. And Kenny Schrader continues to have his problems, and it happened in front of Ned.
Yeah, he just come in there on the outside of Jeff Burton in the car number 8. Got in there a little too hard, Bob, up into the sand. Got some traction. Bunch of cars passed him, but he got her back out there and kept going. And I might mention DW's back out on the track, Darrell Waltrip, while we were on commercial break.
He spent 10 laps in the pits, but apparently has that transmission repaired. Once again, riding with Rusty Wallace, who's in third position. There's quite a bit of distance now between Martin and Earnhardt. But 2, 3, and 4 run right together. Earnhardt, Wallace, and Jeff Gordon.
Well, where did Kyle go? Kyle was running fifth.
Meanwhile, here's what happens to what happened to Derek Cope moments ago.
He's trying to go on the outside of the 09 car, Terry Fisher, and Fisher gets over in his way, and Cope does a little
agricultural racing.
Yeah,
thank you, yes. There's 2, 3, and 4. Here comes Jarrett Labonte. There's Kyle.
Yeah, but Kyle was running fifth here not long ago.
Yep.
And he must have got off course somewhere else, too. And here's a pass trying to be made here in turn 7. Did we pick it up? Rusty on the outside of the car 3, but couldn't do it as we watch Kyle see what happened to him.
Now he looks like he's going to lose another position. Here's Rudd to the inside. Nope.
Kyle looks like when he comes down to turn 11 there that his car is pushing. He comes down the corner and the car just will not stay on the bottom of the racetrack. Either his brakes are hot and not able to stop the car, or he's picked up a push.
Jarrett and Labonte, they're racing for fifth place. Jerry has more on Kyle Petty's problems.
Well, Benny Parsons, you are exactly right with Kyle Petty. That's exactly what the problem is. His car is so tight, he's got to push, but the reason he has to push is a minute ago up in the turn, he missed the brake pedal, according to what Barry Dawson told me. Dawson, hey, I missed the brake pedal. I went off the racetrack, and I may have towed the car out a little bit. Now I picked up a push, and I can't get the car to turn. We'll have to try to fix it if we can on our final pit stop. Bob?
All right. We take a look at Kyle up ahead from Ricky Rudd's roof camp. They'll get the cross flags indicating halfway. Ted Musgrave, meanwhile, is right behind Rudd. And behind Musgrave is Jeff Bodine, all carrying cameras in some different locations.
See how much brake they use up there in front of you, Ned.
Yeah, there's a lot of brake coming into this turn to get down into second gear. Musgrave and Jeff Bodine side by side there for a moment, but Musgrave still out front. There's Ken Schrader back there trying to make up positions, and here's the battle for second.
Rusty, boy, right on the back bumper of Earnhardt, trying to accelerate off, but man, he nails the gas, gets it sideways, and not able to take over the spot. As we watch this, I'll tell you that Jeff Bodine was able to get by Ted Musgrave down in turn 11. And Jeff Gordon watching, looks like he might have a car as fast as any of those two.
Yeah, he's been keeping the pressure on Rusty, if Rusty keeps it on Earnhardt. He has really been working on Earnhardt in turn 7.
This is only Jeff Gordon's third race here at Sonoma. His best finish came in 93. He finished 11th. Rusty Wallace, of course, has won 5 times on road courses. His most recent victory was here at Sears Point in 1990. Earnhardt has never won a road course race, as we discussed earlier.
It's unbelievable to me that Rusty Wallace... Oh, and what happened? We got Dave Marcus.
I was coming up the hill toward turn 2 and 3. Looks like Dave's okay, but he sure damaged the right side of it.
Yeah, we can see that the right front tire is rubbing the fender. That's where the smoke is coming from. But we were talking about Rusty Wallace hasn't won since 1990 on a road course. That's unbelievable.
It really is. Yep, it's been 5 years. All right, let's replay this, see what happened.
There we see Marcus make some contact with Wally Dahlenbach. Now he goes over and bangs into Dahlenbach, and looks like Dave got the worst end of the deal.
It sure does. And from another angle. Now Dave got way over into the dirt. Came back across the track, kept on going though, but...
Oh, and Jeff Bodine spins right in front of me. and is sitting facing traffic. There he is. There comes Hutton Griffin by. No, now don't turn now, Jeff. Don't turn now. Okay, turn now. Man.
So Jeff Bodine will lose some track position because of his spin there in turn 11.
Yeah, here passed Musgrave to take over. What was that spot a moment ago?
Ninth.
Ninth spot.
Yeah.
And Wally Dallenbach after that bang with Dave Marcus heads for the pits. There we see him coming the corner. He's trying, I guess, to get on the outside of Ricky Rudd. And around the back end went and has to sit there and watch all those cars go by.
But he's running again. We're 36 laps from the finish of this race. It's Martin, Earnhardt, Wallace, Gordon, and Terry Labonte.
With each race, he faces a new challenge, a fresh shot at the pole, and another chance to win this season's overall prize, the Busch Series Pole Award. Only then will he earn a ride at Daytona, where he'll run with the big boys in the Busch Clash. We're proud to be with him from the first turn to the last. Busch, the official beer of NASCAR.
Day, we all find a way. A promise made, a promise kept, giving it our best.
America's most complete source of auto parts, a national warranty program, and customer service only NAPA can give. No wonder more people trust NAPA to keep their vehicles running.
We keep America running.
With new spark plugs, you get improved performance for a while. But only Bosch Platinum has a pure platinum center electrode that's heat-fused for an airtight seal. So Bosch Platinum reaches its self-cleaning temperature faster for full engine power over a longer performance life. Which means you'll replace a lot of other things before you change your Bosch Platinums. Bosch Platinum, the ultimate spark plug.
Some say this could be the Mariners' year. This week, they'll have to get past Chili Davis, Lee Smith, and the California Angels. The Mariners visit the Big A. Sunday Night Baseball, tonight at 8, only on ESPN.
Welcome back to Sears Point Raceway, Sonoma, California. We're riding with Mark Martin while we show you the Fram Field Summary, where everybody is running here. Martin ahead of Earnhardt, Wallace, Gordon, and Labonte. Here's the second 15, being led by Derek Cope. You can see 35 cars on the lead lap. Now some replays for you as Mark goes around corner number 11 and is about to complete another lap. Now here's Jeff Bodine's spin.
You can see closed in on the back bumper of Ricky Rudd so fast he just looped the car around. Let's watch what Ted Musgrave sees and listen. Musgrave said, let me away from there.
Here's a Budweiser race recap. Mark Martin has led all but six laps. We've had three lead changes, three caution periods for a total of seven laps, and we're averaging 71.7 miles an hour. Only three drivers have picked up the five bonus points so far. Besides Martin, Ricky Rudd and Ken Schrader. Rudd was the pole sitter. And three cars listed as out of the race, and all of them are Winston West drivers. The 45 car of Wally Dallenbach is on pit road, and penalty box situation here, I believe. The contact from the incident he had earlier has put him in the pit area to be repaired.
And you can see they're working under the car. I don't know exactly what they're doing. Maybe the thing is jammed in gear or something. I really don't know. You see the jack stand under the car. That means that someone was under the car. NASCAR rule, you got to have the jack stand there. See, Ted Musgrave closes up on the back bumper of our pole sitter, Ricky Rudd, as they go down towards me in turn 11. They're heading straight for me.
the fortunes they turn. They don't want to here to visit me.
That's seventh, eighth, and ninth right there. Kyle, Ricky, and Ted. Looks like Kyle locked him up there, or at least he smoked the car as they came into turn two.
Yeah, his car is pushing so bad when he goes in the corner, he's got to stop the just slam on the brakes and try to get it to stop so he can get on around the corner.
Guys, if you watch this, we might also mention for the late speed fan that he's back out on the track after spending a lot of time in the garage area.
Here's the foot cam inside Ricky Rudd's tie four. As he accelerates off four and heads up towards Ned.
But just a pleasure to see him work those beacon. He's working on Kyle Petty here right now, and Musgrave working on the thread. But no change of positions here. They hit the end. Well, look how close they come to the inside of this ripple strip, getting up on them a little bit sometimes. Trying to make the track as straight as they possibly can.
Now we see if Musgrave can come over. He's going to try to outbrake Rudd. Getting in the corner. And we see him. Smoke out that right front. And Musgrave takes the spot away.
He's there.
They race side by side across the finish line. Rudd has the inside line here. He may get the position back. Yep, he did.
That position was kind of short-lived, wasn't it?
Yeah. Wally Donovan is back in the race. Three laps down, 35th place. While we continue to watch this battle among three cars, Petty, Rudd, and Musgrave.
This is turn five. They're going around. They go up a hill. And watch us go over this horizon. Man, you got to be on your toes when you top that hill.
Yeah, you come sort of into a blind spot there.
You won a race at Riverside, didn't you, Benny?
Yeah. Back in the 70s.
And Ned, you've, I'm sure, driven Watkins Glen a couple of times.
Yep, had a second place finish over there. That's my best finish in road racing. But as I mentioned to some people I was talking to this morning, back when I was driving race cars, we used basically a short track car, Bob.
Yep.
We just reversed the setup on the thing. We didn't have specialty road race cars like they have nowadays. Some teams have a road racer for this track, a race car for this track, and one for Watkins Glen, because the turns are different. There's a world of difference in those cars.
You will see Rudd on the inside of Kyle Petty trying to take the spot away. Now Musgrave is going to try to follow Rudd, I'm sure.
And I think Kyle's going to let him go.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
No, he didn't, did he?
No, he didn't.
He let Rudd go, but moved up between them.
He didn't have much choice as far as Kyle Petty's concerned, but he did on Ted Musgrave, and he said, I'm racing. I haven't been able to do a lot of that this year, but we're back. We're racing.
It has been a very impressive performance from Kyle Petty. Remember, he did win at Watkins Glen in 1992 with a rain shortened event, but he does have one victory on a road course. Ooh, good side-by-side action with Petty and Musgrave.
And that's not the place on the racetrack that you want to try to pass, but Musgrave apparently thought he saw an opportunity
that couldn't quite pull it off. And you can see how far Ricky Rudd has pulled away from Kyle Petty since he was able to get by down in turn 11.
Little contact there, Ned.
Yeah, just a little bit as he came into the turn, but Kyle's still going to come out in front. Bill Elliott right behind them now. Michael Walker, some cars have closed up on him. So they got about a six-car race there now. As Michael Waltrip has closed up there, Bill Elliott is there, Sterling Marlin is there, and Todd Bodine.
be Darrell Waltrip back in the race, and there's the leader and second place. That's Joe Nemechek coming back out onto the racetrack after his crash. He was in the pits for 17 laps. This is the battle for third spot now. As Jeff Gordon appears to be possibly a little faster than Rusty, but can't find the chance to get around him. So that's the way they run. 44 out of 74 laps have been completed. It is Mark Martin still leading here at Sears Point.
Budweiser King Top Fuel Dragster. Who says you need wings to fly? You've got 700 horsepower trucks. You've got Craftsman tools. You've got heart pounding, bone rattling, eardrum busting speed. What else do you need for a perfect Sunday afternoon? The all-new NASCAR Super Truck Series, brought to you by Craftsman. The only tools tough enough for super trucks.
Hi, I'm Bob. I work in the automotive department at Walmart. I first started working on cars back in the 50s, so I've been around automobiles all my life. I have a lot of friends now, customer friends. It's my job to help them make a decision on what's best for their car. I like Quaker State 4x4. It's a good synthetic blend. They call it the intelligent oil for hard-working engines. It's good for pulling campers or boats or for going off-road. I care about customers' cars just like I care about my own. So it's fun to work here.
Today, millions of Americans are running faster with the same size engines and farther on the same amount of fuel. Millions have discovered the patented advantages of the Splitfire spark plug, a difference that delivers on every stroke of every piston. 5 extra horsepower by merely installing these plugs. A 4.8% gain in mileage. If you're not running the Splitfire, you're probably behind someone who is. Splitfire, more power and more mileage for your money back.
During the playoffs, I take every opportunity to work on my game. I work on my passing, my shooting, and especially my body checking.
Welcome back to Sears Point. There are the top 15 with 45 laps completed. And while we were away, we had some beating and banging as Ted Musgrave and Kyle Petty went at it.
Coming up towards Ned Jarrett, turn 7. And Musgrave gets on the inside. Ooh, and they get together. Now watch the front quarter panel as they come in there at the front fender. Boy, they get together pretty heavy there, Bob.
Put a big donut there behind the right front tire. And also, while we were away, look at what happened for third position.
Coming into turn 7, Jeff Gordon gets up on the outside of Rusty Wallace. Rusty gives him plenty of room out there. They don't touch. And Jeff Gordon gets the better bite off the turn and takes the position.
Dr. Jerry Punch has more on the 42 of Kyle Petty.
Well, we told you Kyle thought he had a tire towed out of the right front. That may have fixed it a moment ago, buffered with Musgrave. But anyway, he said the car is such a bad push, they need to be able to pit. Now, what Barry Dodson said was, just hang on. You got to hang on. We want to make just one more stop, which means we can only go 27 and a half laps on fuel, which means we've got to go to lap 47 here to be able to make it. But now, apparently, they are going to call Kyle Petty in next time by because Kyle said the tire may be going down. The crew is just up on the wall.
And oh, and Bill Elliott spins right ahead of Kyle Petty.
Looks like he might have a flat tire or something because he slowed as we were watching Kyle Petty. It looks to me like the right rear tire might be flat on that car. Yeah, I think it is, Benny.
Yep, it is. Yep.
He was running in 12th position when this spin occurred.
Boy, he's got a long way to go to get back to the pits. That was coming into turn 6.
Bill, you better slow down. Your tire's flat.
This is turn seven that he's in right now. Jeff Burton goes by on the outside.
Here's the replay.
Yeah, and I think the tire's already flat right there when he comes into the thing. It looked like he was chasing it. And around he went.
Tough, tough break with McDonald's Ford of Bill Elliott. Here we can see it coming down the S's. And that tire is starting to tear itself apart. There it fell apart. Nothing but the rim now. Nothing but the rim of the tire, of the wheel. Well, I guess there's a little piece of something there.
I don't know. They probably don't run interliners here, though, do they?
No, they don't.
Finally makes it to the pits. Elliott started 19th and moved up to 12th. And suffered a flat tire that sent him off course.
If he could just stay in the lead lap, he'll be okay. John Kernan.
Well, as Bill Elliott slows down to get into his pit stall, I went up to Tony Gibson and asked him what the problem was. When you spotted it, Tony did not know there was a problem. I had to tell him he had a flat, and then Bill radioed in and said the right rear is going down. So they will change the four tires. They should be okay as far as going the rest of the way on fuel, but the key right now, getting serviced and out without losing the lap. They're working on the right side. That's all they're going to change, right side tires. A little bit of a problem against Martin comes down into turn 11, having a problem with that right rear, it looks like. I think that, and Martin will come around and Bill Elliott will lose a lap there on the right side. I can't see exactly what the problem is with Bill Elliott's car.
The 09 has a flat right front. He's in the pits. That is Terry Fisher, one of the Winston West drivers.
Now that's Gilligan's Island where they're pitting over there. That's an island in the middle of the racetrack.
Here's Terry Labonte coming down pit road.
Terry was running in fifth place.
Kyle Petty is also making a pit stop.
And Kyle Petty says, none too soon for him.
We've got 26 laps to go, Doc.
And they were having to wait on Kyle Petty's pit stop because it could only go 27 and a half laps for fuel. And they had to get past lap 47, which was the last time by. So Kyle is stretching it as it was. He said, hey, we have got to change these tires. He knew he got a bad set of tires for the car. Is towed out so bad, we got to push. We just can't drive it. So Kyle now already having changed right side tires. Gets left side tires put on the Coors Light Silverboard Pontiac. He is down and away.
18 and a half second pit stop for Kyle Petty in the Coors Light Pontiac.
Now, back up front, guys, as we watch Kyle get back up to speed, Dale Earnhardt is gaining on Mark Martin.
What happened the last time coming in turn 11? Martin ran across that 09 car, Terry Fisher with a flat tire, and also Dave Marcus side by side. He had to almost stop to clear those cars coming in turn 11. That's why Earnhardt was able to get so much closer. And Earnhardt now makes a pit stop. And here comes Rusty Wallace, the 10 car of Ricky Rudd, and Dale Jarrett on the racetrack. Ned, has he got a flat tire?
I've heard a report that he might have a flat tire. I know he had slowed down some on the last lap, so he'll be coming into the pits too. There's Earnhardt heading towards his pit, 35 miles an hour down pit road.
All the way down to the end pit where Jerry is stationed.
Final pit stop for the seventh time. Winston Cup champion. Thus far, no chassis adjustment. NASCAR allowing an eighth man, if you're counting at home, over the wall to swing the windshield because of all the dirt and debris. Leave shuttle on the racetrack. So don't look for a penalty here. The eighth man is allowed. Right side tires already have it going on. Left side going on. It's full of fuel. And he heads out of the pits. Let's go to John Kernan. Four tire change for Sterling Marlin. No chassis adjustment. Left side's on as Dale Jarrett with a flat left tire. Gets down pit road. Sterling Marlin, the work finished. He is down and away.
And the 28 car of Jarrett has made it around after the flat tire that he sustained. Working on the right side of that car, now moving around to the left.
But the left side is what's flat on the car, and it will be able to get the jack under. No, they can't. Lift the car up, guys. Come on, lift it up. Jeff Clark is in. I cannot get the jack up. He finally gets the jack under the car so they can change the tire.
Well, that's going to cost them a lot of extra time. Lost some time on the racetrack, then a lot of extra time in the pits.
Once again, Mark Martin. He's playing all the luck he can, does not pitch.
So Mark Martin has not yet stopped for his second pit stop. He remains in the lead here at the St. Mark's Supermarket 300.
You know, a lot of people who work on their cars will only shop at AutoZone. They depend on us for the best quality parts and low prices every day. They come in, get what they need, and then get back to work. Because you see, they believe if you want the job done right, you do it yourself. Well, at AutoZone, we couldn't agree more. Because when you take the time and the effort to work on your car yourself, you ought to be choosy about where you shop. We just thank you for choosing AutoZone.
Hey, you know my crew spends hundreds of hours building those 5,000 horsepower motors? I can explode one in 5 seconds. And when that happens, nobody eats. That's why my guys won't run anything but Fram fillers. You know, Fram gets the nasty stuff out of the oil, so I can go to the other end with my candles lit. And you know, that's in about 5 seconds, nearly 300 miles an hour. You can look at these guys and see they eat pretty near every day.
Now, an oil made just for your hard-working engine. 4x4 from Quaker State. Off-roading, extreme temperatures, towing and hauling. They all make your light truck or 4x4 work extra hard and could shorten its life. Why settle for a conventional car oil? Get 4x4 from Quaker State.
Now, an independent test proved 4x4 superior to leading conventional car oils in protecting against deposits that can shorten engine life.
New Zealand's in the lead for the America's Cup. Can Dennis Conner steal the wind and sail to victory?
When we're behind in the race, we would try to attack and hope the other team would make a mistake.
New Zealand plans to zig to their zag and take the cup home.
When you're ahead, you force the opposition the wrong way so that you can increase your lead.
Who will steal the wind and rule the sea? The race continues tomorrow at 4 on ESPN.
Raceway. Final pit stop of the day for our leader, Mark Martin, who has dominated the afternoon as Earnhardt is up in turn 10, coming down toward the slowest part of the course, turn 11, as left side tires are on the Valvoline Ford Thunderbird. He is down and away for his final stop.
And here comes Dale Earnhardt. There he is. That Goodrich Chevrolet trying his best to catch Mark Martin. He'll not be able to do it on the pit stop.
Nope, Mark is not quite up to speed, but he's going to be able to stay ahead of Dale Earnhardt. There's Jeff Gordon, who is in third place. Earnhardt leads all drivers with 26 top 10 finishes and 35 road course events. He finished third here last year, his best finish at Sears Point. And he is within now just a couple of car lengths of Mark.
He ran, one or two laps after on fresher tires than Mark had after he came back out. There we see Dick Trickle over in the infield. That's Gilligan's Island. They're calling that car the USS Minnow.
Gilligan's Island is an area across from the regular pits because there's not enough room in the regular pits.
Excuse me, Bob, but you see the NASCAR official standing in front of the car? It's a 10-second penalty for pitting in there because you make up that much time when you come in. There you see, that's why they call it Gilligan's Island. There's a racetrack to the right and the racetrack to the left. And you see how they get to the trucks and get parts? They don't. They got to take them with them or they don't use them.
Earnhardt closing in on Martin.
Turn 11, and you're right, he closes right in on the back bumper of Mark Martin.
Nor Gordon has led a lap here today. If the race were to end right now, Mark Martin would have the points lead by 6 over Dale Earnhardt. He's in the lead, and we have 51 laps completed.
We are pleased to announce that First National Bank of Manatee has established a trust department. We feel certain that we can provide you personalized service while taking care of your trust and estate administrative needs. First National Bank is the only community bank in Manatee County to have a trust department.
is our goal to allow our customers to feel comfortable dealing with their investment in estate planning. You have our standing invitation to meet with us and talk in confidence with absolutely no obligation. Come in and experience the personal touch you can bank on.
We wanted to show you how the Toro Recycler 2 More gives you a beautiful lawn without bagging or raking. We wanted to show how it's guaranteed to start on the first or second pull, or we'll fix it free. In fact, we wanted to show you all the quality features of the Toro Recycler, but then we couldn't show you the more.
Stop in and see our complete line of Toro mowers at Jeffries Service Center. We make mowing easy.
All of us get busy with what we do every week. However, there's nothing more important than spending time with your family.
Good night, air. Good night, noise everywhere. Take a moment and do something special with your family. You should never be too busy.
Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Daddy.
This message brought to you by NASCAR. The teams, the tracks, the drivers.
Welcome back to Steers Point. There are the top 15 as we look back on Dale Earnhardt from Mark Martin's car. The top three running right together on the racetrack, Martin, Earnhardt, and Gordon.
And you can see that flat tire cost Dale Jarrett a whole bunch, didn't it, Ned?
Yeah, he was running in fifth place when he had the flat tire, so now he's back in 26th place.
And 33 cars remain on the lead lap. Bill Elliott has slipped back to 33rd due to his flat tire and off-course excursion. And four cars have officially dropped out of the race. Most recently, Wally Dallenbacher. Here comes fourth and fifth.
Rusty Wallace in fourth. Ricky Rudd in fifth place. Rudd is in fifth. Wallace now. And then the Rudd had dropped back there in the early part of the race, but he's been gradually working his way back up.
Bobby Hamilton and Bobby Labonte are right together.
Yes, they are, coming into turn seven. Labonte had a notion to try to go on the outside. Here's Ken Prater in that battle as well in the car 25. No pass here.
As we said before, Ned, this is not a very good place to pass down through the S's.
This is 16th, 17th, and 18th.
Let's see what Bobby Labonte can do as he come in turn 11. Oh, there we watch Rusty Wallace and Ricky Rudd going up the hill. I guess that's a turn two. Yes, it was. Turn four. Down to turn five. Now they'll accelerate up to the carousel. And make that left corner and head towards Ned Jarrett.
Coming into the turn. He gains on him coming into the turn.
Ken Schrader still trying to get by Bobby Hamilton as Labonte has dropped back behind these two.
Yeah, Schrader was able to get by Bobby Labonte, the Interstate Battery car.
John Kernan has a report on Bobby Hamilton is running 17th.
Well, Bob, that car is the same car that Wally Dallenbach drove for the Petty team last year and had some great runs on the race course with Watkins Glen and also here at Sears Point. In fact, Bobby Hamilton says that the team has more road course car than they have road course driver, but he's doing okay out there.
There's Schrader got up on the outside and coming into turn seven, and he made the pass as they came off the turn and hit through the S's. Puts him up in 16th position.
Battle continuing between Rusty Wallace and Ricky Rudd for third, or fourth rather.
great deal.
So what's the situation? Is Rusty Wallace gaining on Jeff Gordon? Well, let's check that out. You know, there are really two parts of this racetrack. There's a technical aspect and a fast side of the track. And we've timed Gordon and Wallace. Look how much better Gordon is to the technical part of the track than Rusty Wallace. And you can see by that, that there is indeed no closing up. Gordon is staying ahead of Rusty Wallace, who is regarded as one of, if not the best, road racer in the business.
He's obviously a very good road racer. Right now, Rusty's car just not working exactly right. And Jeff Gordon's car working very, very well. As a matter of fact, Jeff Gordon and Dale Earnhardt keeping all kinds of pressure on Mark Martin. But meanwhile, we're watching Rusty Wallace in the Miller Genuine Draft Ford trying his best to stay in front of Ricky Rudd. Turn six.
And we have a caution flag being waved. The 26 car of Hutch Strickland is just about stopped. He was running 13th, taking that Quaker State Ford for a fine ride.
Now the question, do they pit or don't they pit? Do they change the fresh tires? What do you think, Ned?
Well, I don't know. They'll certainly be racing back to the start-finish line, no question about that. But whether they come in, I think it'll depend on what Mark Martin does, and I doubt if he'll come in. That would surprise me if he comes in.
Here comes Mark and Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon. But Earnhardt right now wants to lead this race. He really wants those 5 bonus points. He'll not get them this lap as Mark comes off the corner straight, square, and accelerates to the start-finish line,
where he and the others will receive the caution flag for the 4th time this afternoon.
Man, this is going to be a tough decision on these guys. Pit or not?
Well, while they take a lap around the track to determine whether they'll come in for a pit stop, we'll make a pit stop and be right back.
Come on along, head for the mountains of Bush Beer. Head for the mountains, it's cold and it's smooth, and it's waiting for you. Come on, head for the mountains of Bush Beer.
I am not what I wear. I'm not a pair of pants or a shirt. I'm not in touch with my inner child. I don't read poetry, and I'm not politically correct. I'm just a guy, and I don't have time to think about what I wear because I've got a lot of important guy things to do. 100% cotton, wrinkle-free pants and shorts that don't require a lot of thought. Haggar, stuff you can wear.
On the road again, I just can't wait to get on the road again.
Now, get on the road in this custom racing jacket for just $19.95 when you buy 4 General, Continental, or Hoosier brand tires. And while you're at it, play our winning drive contest for a chance to win a trip to the General Tire Hoosier 500 in Atlanta.
Sooner or later, you'll own Generals.
Come on along. Head for the mountains of Bush Beer. Head for the mountains, it's cold and it's smooth, and it's waiting for you. Come on, head for the mountains of Bush Beer.
ESPN Speed World coverage of the Save Mart Supermarkets 300 is being brought to you by Firestone, America's tire since 1900. By the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And by cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft, making the world a very cool place. Under caution for the 4th time here at Sears Point, the question is, will the leaders be pitting? We are going to know the answer to that question in just a few minutes. They're up in the S's and headed toward the decision-making area. The crews don't appear to be in any hurry to ready for a pit stop.
Did you see Steve Mills sitting on pit wall? He certainly does not look like he's going to pit now. These guys have picked up an air wrench. And Robin Pemberton, the crew chief, is talking to Rusty and said they're making their plans what they're going to do. Rusty looks like he's getting him a drink. Roush is talking to Steve Mills. Steve Allen. It looks like.
Trying to pick up what he is saying.
Rusty Wallace. Rusty is coming in. At the last instant, Rusty Wallace dove on pit road, and he's the only car that stopped. Wow.
Going to give up a lot of track position, but it may pay off, John.
Well, when I talked to Robin Pemberton just a few moments ago, he was acting as if they would not come in. He said Rusty hadn't said anything about the car. Dale Jarrett also taking an opportunity to come in on pit road. Rusty slowly coming down to his pit stall. He'll pull in. There will be a four-tire change for the Miller Genuine Draft crew. Robin Pemberton didn't indicate any type of chassis adjustment, but they're masters with making air pressure adjustments to get the car just right. Now, Todd Barrett will commit a round wedge in the left rear of the car. Left side tires going on. Rusty Wallace sitting here. Lug nuts being tightened. The gas is pulled down and away in about 21 and a half seconds.
But you know, you can almost see the dejection in the tire changers when he got up and said, man, nobody else stop. What are we going to do now?
Here are some cars that were back in the lead lap that have come in. There's Nemechek.
Bill Elliott. Also, yep. Dale Jarrett stopped.
But behind the pace car still is Mark Martin, who didn't come in and continues to lead at Sonoma.
If you don't replace your air and oil filters regularly, you might as well drive your car off a cliff, because dirt can really mess up an engine. Fram Extra Life air filters and Fram Extra Guard oil filters keep out dirt best to protect your engine. Fram, America's number one premium brand. Pay a little now or a lot later. Get a $2 rebate on Fram air filters at participating retailers.
Monroe developed Sensatrac shocks to smooth out the road for a comfortable ride. But Sensatrac doesn't stop there. It's the only shock that also gives you extra control when you need it most. Sensatrac shocks and struts, only by Monroe, for comfort and control.
You know, working at AutoZone is more than just looking up parts or ringing up sales. Most of all, is listening. Because my customers know more about their cars than I'll ever know. They know every rattle by heart. I mean, that car is their baby. So when they got a problem they're going to fix themselves, I'm going to do my best to help them get whatever they need, no matter what it takes. Because people like that, they don't deserve anything less than the best I can give them.
Here's a breakdown of car manufacturers by positions. In the first 10, there are four Chevys and five Fords, one Pontiac. 11 through 20, three Chevys, five Fords, two Pontiacs. 3 and 7, the breakdown, 21 through 30, 31 through 40, 4, 4 and 2, and 41 and 43, one Chevy and two Fords.
Under caution flag, there was your leader, Mark. I see it. What's that on the right door? The black strip on the right door that goes through the Xerex?
A bungee cord, isn't it?
Looks like something holding up the exhaust pipe on Mark Martin's car.
Well, they
you don't see the black stripe. Looks like a piece of tape on the left side.
Yeah, right. Well, the excitement has gotten to some people. They just can't take it anymore. So they're catching a quick nap here before we go green once again. By the way, we are under caution. Hut Strickland stopped on course, and the 90 car of Mike Wallace was smoking heavily, and they're checking the track for fluid at the moment. Now, the lights atop the pace car will be turned off, what, down around where you are, right, Ned?
Yeah, when they come into turn 7, that's when they turn them off.
Here, let's zoom in here and say, by golly, it is a bungee cord, and it is holding up the header there. Jerry, what's the deal?
They noticed on the first pit stop of the day that the retainer brace that holds the exhaust pipe up had been broken, but they said the exhaust pipe cannot come off because it's kept by another retainer beneath the car. But to keep it from dragging on this pit stop they made a few minutes ago, they took a bungee cord and put the bungee cord to hold it up. Now, Ray Evernham just ran up here and said, "Hey, Steve, you guys got a pitch. You got a bungee cord stuck to the side of your car." They all started laughing. Of course, no one expects or would ever think of the sixth car making another pit stop here today. Let's go to John Kernan.
Jerry, I just talked to Robin Pemberton and asked him what the deal was with him coming into pit. They were running in the top five, and Robin said, well, Rusty wanted to make that pit stop. He wanted to have that adjustment. Remember, they were around a wedge in the left rear of the car, and they're pretty dejected right now because they gave up a lot of positions out there on that racetrack.
Yeah, they sure did. They are way back to 24th position as the lineup is being prepared for the restart. Seems to be flexing that right arm a lot. What's the deal there, Benny?
That's Rusty Wallace. That's vintage Rusty Wallace. He does that when he gets ready to shift. He gets ready when he grab that steering wheel. He's ready. He's just getting ready. That's what he's doing.
Well, we've seen repairs made by many things today. Rubber bands, scotch tape, vice grips, and the latest a bungee cord. We'll be right back.
They were the tires that created giants.
Been developed just for the 500.
That turned a cornfield into the greatest spectacle in racing. The tires that took home 48 checkered flags from the Indy 500. On May 28th, 1995, Firestone will return to Indy to prove that yesterday isn't all we have to be proud of.
I keep having this dream. I can feel every turn, every move, every spin. It's wild. Then I wake up.
Sea-Doo. Hold on to your dreams and hold on tight.
Everybody's doing it. Sea-Doo. Sea-Doo.
Genuine draft Rusty Wallace stock car. Awesome. One opened up.
Just about to go back to green flag racing, but if points were awarded right now, Mark Martin would be on top, moving up two positions. Earnhardt and Gordon would be separated now by five and lose a position. Marlin would be third, and Ted Musgrave fifth in the point standings. But we do have several more laps to go, and anything can happen. The only thing certain right now is the lights atop the pace car are off, and the green flag is not too far away.
Yeah, we've still got to get this contest decided before we can start awarding points. And you know, when we saw these cars a moment ago going through turns one and two, NASCAR officials and the track officials had put some oil dry down to soak up that oil that someone lost, maybe Hutch Strickland in the Quaker State car. Now then, as Martin goes charging in there wide open, oil dry is going to be in the racetrack. Needs to be just a little careful. That stuff can be awfully slippery. As we saw at Talladega last week when Dale Earnhardt made that pit stop and they put oil dry under the right front tire to make it spin.
Yep. Okay, the pace car will go straight down the drag strip.
And Mark is very, very slow. He's bringing down this field awfully slow. They're almost stopped back there where I am.
Trying to get the jump on Earnhardt. He didn't get much of a jump, though, as Dale is right on his back bumper again. We head for the green flag.
Now, into turn two, is the oil dry off the racetrack? Looks like it is. You can see the white line where they put the stuff down. All the cars through the corner, good.
There we see the green car, number 33 of Robert Presley. He's a lap down, so he's just moving over, giving him some running room.
There's Todd Bodine in the 75 car. He's up to eighth position, started 26th. It's his 50th NASCAR Winston Cup race, and he's doing a fine job.
Robert Presley.
around by there in a hurry. Jeff Gordon trying to make a move on Dale Earnhardt here. Don't believe it's going to work. Nope, not this time, Bob.
Remember, he passed on the outside there quite a while ago, like he was thinking about doing it again.
And Rusty Wallace spins here in turn eight. Dale Jarrett goes over, trying to get it up on the side. He hits the base. And Davy Jones is involved.
Dale Jarrett is up on his side.
Yeah, he got into that dirt bank, Bob. And certainly an uncomfortable way to be hanging your belt. He just tried to get that thing righted.
Hey, Ned.
Yeah.
If you want to get unhooked and go down and check on him, be okay with me.
Well, I understand. But I feel comfortable that he is okay because, you know, he got into that bank and it just, he was dodging Rusty Wallace. We understand that he has that on the radio and that worker is trying to push him over. The worker just needs one more hand there. Maybe I'll go there and help him. Now the wrecker's coming there. I'd go to help do it myself, but they're going to get there before I could. He's only about 75 yards from me.
Now they're going to get it over there. There we go.
Now to get him out going. He can stay in the lead lap.
I was going to say, he could very easily get
that thing going again. Give me a push. That's what he's saying to the guys. Give me a push.
And Rusty Wallace is back on pit road.
Okay, Dale Jarrett's off and going.
And here's a look at it again, Ned.
Okay, they were really tightened up coming in here. You see the 25 car to the 33 get together there maybe just a little bit coming in. And then here comes Rusty into the picture. He was up beside trying to pass Ward Burton, and Dale Jarrett just trying to dodge him, locked his brakes, but he got on the grass about the time he locked the brakes. And into that dirt bank he went, and it just stood right up on the side. But again, Dale is gone. Stayed in the lead lap.
Work continues on Rusty's car, John.
Well, a lot of sheet metal damage on the left rear. They're having to pull it out to make sure it doesn't rub up against that left rear tire. In fact, they did the work on the left side first. Now they're going around and will change the right side tires as Rusty sits here. They're waiting. Bill Wilburn on the radio. They've gotten the problems fixed, but what problems they could fix, and Rusty is now down and away.
We are under caution once again because of an accident up in turn number 7 involving Rusty Wallace, Dale Jarrett, and others.
Ever since it was first introduced, Ford Taurus has made a really big splash. Still does. After all, Taurus has been America's best-selling car 3 years in a row. Maybe it's because of this great deal. Maybe it's because you get so much car. It's loaded with dual airbags, V6 power, air conditioning, and more. And then again, maybe it's because of that great paint job. Make a splash of your own. See your local Southern Ford dealer today.
Child, and I've got a theory that food tastes better at the beach. We're proving it every day at the Beach House.
I take every opportunity to work on my game, to work on my passing, my shooting, and especially my body checking.
When traffic congestion changes, the threats to your car's engine change. That's why Quaker State has engineered intelligent oil. Oil that senses the changing threats in your engine and adapts its own molecular structure for continuous protection. So whenever the driving conditions change, so does Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
Now you can change to the intelligent oil and save $3.60 on a case of Quaker State. See store display for details.
ESPN Speed World today is live at Sears Point Raceway, Sonoma, California, and the Save Mart Supermarkets 300. Dale Jarrett is trailing some sheet metal.
That's, I think he's pushing it. Rather than trailing, I think he's pushing it. That's the left front where he hit the bank up there in front of Ned. There we see, and the left front tire, I don't think it's even flat yet. All they got to do is go in the pits, get that sheet metal off there, and change those left side tires. We see Rusty has some damage to the front of the car they're trying to fix.
Now the hood goes up on the Miller Genuine Draft Ford. Well, we told you a while ago at the long distance haul that the truck drivers had to make in these transporters from Talladega out here this past week. And then after the truck drivers got here, they had a race to do, part of the Mayflower Challenge. Last year's champion hasn't qualified for the finals yet, but when they came out here to Sonoma, it was the defending champion of the Mayflower Challenge, Rodney Pickler, coming home a winner, picking up the paycheck here. And now let's take a look at the point standings. Rodney Pickler, the results from today's challenge. Ricky Simmons finishes second and Steve Foster in third. And now the points. Tommy Rigsby holds on to first. William Marshburn from seventh to second. Earl Barbin and Ricky Simmons are tied for third. And Pickler moves up to fourth position from 14th. So he picked up 10 positions in the Mayflower Challenge, and the next event is going to be in Pocono, Pennsylvania. We'll keep you updated on how things go with the Mayflower Trucker Challenge. Rodney Pickler, yeah, has moved up to 14th, picking up 10 spots. Rusty Wallace back out on the racetrack after another pit stop.
Rusty Wallace is losing that fluid that we see him trying to clean up. I don't know what it is, and I guess that's why they raised the hood. But maybe he's broken an oil line, or it's overheating, water coming out, I don't know. That looks like you're putting down something for oil.
And it started right here where he, when he got involved in that wreck in turn seven, Benny, and he was stalled there, and right from the position he left from, there's just a streak of oil from there all the way around. There we see Dale Jarrett's back out there, minus the left front fender. Sure, he's got four new tires on that Haviland Ford, and we'll go to John Kernan. He can tell us exactly what they did to it.
Well, they had to cut away that left front fender, or what was remaining of the left front fender. They also, some of the supports on the left front of the nose underneath the car, they had to cut away. They had been pushed back and were actually pushing up against the brake rotor, so they had to cut those things away. Of course, they changed all four tires, pulled away the sheet metal to keep it from rubbing on the car, on the tires, and he finally left. But it was a very lengthy stay on pit road for Dale Jarrett. Trying to check in to find out exactly what the problem is with Rusty. I'll get back with you just as soon as I find out.
Well, you know, guys, talking about Rusty, that was a very costly pit stop. He was running in the top five and elected to make that pit stop, and he got back there where he's more subject to get in trouble.
Yep, both he and Rusty were in that situation. Now he catches up with the field and gets set along with the rest of us for a restart when we come back to Sonoma.
Well, the battery's good and starter's brand new, so I figure it's got to be the alternator, right? I go into the AutoZone, get a new one. Well, this guy says, well, let's check the old one first. No sense buying something you may not need. Well, turns out it's a voltage regulator. I tell you, I could have spent a lot of time swapping out parts till I got it right. But with AutoZone, piece of cake.
With Miller Genuine Draft, the world's a very cool place. Rule number 60, hooking. Rule number 69, slow whistle. Rule number 29, gross misconduct. Rule number 25, to play the game, use a puck. The Stanley Cup playoffs continue tonight at 7:30 Eastern. NHL rules on ESPN2.
Still under caution at Sonoma. Looking back on second place Dale Earnhardt from leader Mark Martin's car. Behind Earnhardt is Jeff Gordon.
You know, just a couple of laps ago, I talked about the oil drop in one and two, the speedy dry. Watches these cars go through that, and that can be very slippery. You got to be careful when you go into these corners at high speed and hit that oil drop. Last week,
at Talladega. It was unbelievable. Dale Earnhardt, he had been choking the car down as he left the pits, the car bogging down. Watch as they spread oil dry under that right front tire to make it spin, and you saw it spin for just a second. Watch as it works so perfect for Andy Petrie and the guys. Watch, they spread the oil dry down right there. Now, as the car starts accelerating, you'll see that the oil dry actually sticks to that hot tire as it rolls through. You see it, and it spins for just an instant. That's enough to get that Goodrich Chevrolet on the move. A great move by Andy Petrie and his crew.
Have you ever seen that done before, Benny, and why would they do that?
Why do they do it? Because I was talking to Andy Petrie on Friday. He said, man, you know, Earnhardt keeps bogging the motor down when he makes these stops. He said, it's too bad to want some oil dry on pit road, you know, because it would make the tire spin. Why don't we put some oil dry on pit road? It's just a spur of the moment thing, and it worked like a champ.
First time you'd ever seen that?
First time I'd ever seen it done.
Yeah.
And we can see all the oil. There's a truck back putting the oil dry down. And, you know, they said that the two car was losing oil. But Robin Timmerson reported, I guess, to John Kernan that they're losing oil. That must have been from the 77 car when he hit Rusty Wallace up in turn 7 in front of Mitch.
Yeah, they were right together. And from the point where they moved away from, that's where the streak started. And that's what you're watching here now off of turn 7 as they head in towards the Estes. And they must have put a lot of it all the way down there because they've come back for the third time and put the oil dry down here starting from the spot where Rusty Wallace and Davey Jones wrecked.
He doesn't lose very much, but Rusty Wallace will have to go to the end of the longest line because he came in while the...
Hey, Bob.
Yeah.
Bob, there's only one line.
Well, I know, but there are only 6-7 cars that he will have to go behind. It's not like he's going to have to go behind...
I see what I mean.
Jerry is with Andy Petrie.
Andy, we just showed last week that ingenious move you guys had on pit road to put some oil dry down under your car on that final stop. Why'd you do it?
Well, we were having trouble with the car getting going. It was choking the motor down when we took off, so we figured if we could just break the wheels loose and spin the wheels a little bit, it'd let the motor rev up and we could take off quicker. So, you know, we kind of laughed about it, talked about putting some speedy dry under the tire, and I said, hey, why not? Let's try it. So we had a guy we could send over the wall. We were just doing gas only. Sent him around there and had him dump it right under the tire, and it seemed to work pretty good.
Now, what do you have this week? Any kind of magic you've got for Mark in these final laps?
Well, there's not much we can do because we're not going to pit again. I don't know if Dale's got anything for Mark. If he does, we'll find out, but it looks like Mark's pretty strong.
Well, Mark's awfully strong, but the three cars probably has a little bit left. We'll see what he can use up in these last 15 laps or so, Bob.
All right. The caution remains on. It is Martin, Earnhardt, Gordon, Rudd, and Terry Labonte, the top five with just 11 laps to go now in the Save Mart Supermarkets 300.
I love my new hot rod. Those flames scare the other guys. 5,000 horsepower helps too. And a fat bankroll. You know, we've been running Autolite spark plugs forever, but I could wring more money out of someone else. Money's good. My crew burns it. So I tell the guys we're going to run a different plug. They say no. I say I'm the boss. They say Autolite keeps this monster lit. So I tell them I was just kidding.
What, is this your idea of excitement? Let me tell you about exciting, okay? Driving around a racetrack at over 200 miles an hour, that's exciting. These are just flakes.
Well, what do you think?
These are really good. They're crispy, too.
Really?
Yeah, they're mighty good even with nothing on them. What are they?
Hey, Charlie.
Yeah.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes?
How could I be so dumb?
You got 500 miles to think about it.
Kellogg's is proud to sponsor NASCAR champion Terry Labonte.
Honey, quick, look at this Taco Bell commercial.
Get to Taco Bell this Monday, May 8th from 1 to 4 p.m. for the Border Light Celebration. Try any great-tasting Border Light taco or burrito free. You don't have to buy a thing.
Free Border Light tacos or burritos this Monday? Play that back.
And millions of people have enjoyed Border Lights already, so what are you waiting for?
That looks great. Go forward.
Bell this Monday, May 8th from 1 to 4 p.m. for the Border Light Celebration. Try any great-tasting Border Light taco or burrito free.
We're out of here.
So come on down.
We're a little more than a half a lap from the green flag. However, we do have time to take another break before we return here and wave the green flag and start racing once again. So stay with us. We'll be right back for Green Flag Racing at Sonoma.
When it comes to roping a steer, folks in Grand Junction, Colorado will tell you that Ron Markin can ride with the best of them. And when it comes to overhauling an engine or rebuilding a carburetor, well, he can do it all. You see, when Ron's not riding a horse for fun, he's turning a wrench for a living. So he buys a lot of parts, mostly from AutoZone. Sure, there are other parts stores in town, but Ron knows that when you want the right part for the right price, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
When traffic congestion changes, the threats to your car's engine change. That's why Quaker State has engineered intelligent oil. Oil that senses the changing threats in your engine and adapts its own molecular structure for continuous protection. So whenever the driving conditions change, so does Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life.
Now you can change to the intelligent oil and save $3.60 on a case of Quaker State. See store display for details.
Hey, you know, my crew spends hundreds of hours building those 5,000 horsepower motors. I can explode one in 5 seconds. And when that happens, nobody eats. That's why my guys won't run anything but Fram fillers. You know, Fram gets the nasty stuff out of the oil, so I can go to the other end with my candles lit. And you know, that's in about 5 seconds, nearly 300 miles an hour. You can look at these guys and see they eat pretty near every day.
Here are the top 15 as we show you an Autolite field summary and get set for the green flag to come out once again. You see the cars scrubbing their good years, getting set for high speed competition. They go through turn number 11.
And once again, Mark Martin, there's all the 43 cars. Mark Martin, the last time, brought them down at a very, very slow speed. And again, it's looks like they're doing 20 miles an hour as they're anticipating the green, and Martin nailed it.
Here we go. The green is waving.
He didn't want to have Earnhardt to have a chance to get up beside him before he got into the turns.
9 laps to go. And Earnhardt is all over Martin. For his very first road course win, Mark Martin trying to make it 2 consecutive Winston Cup wins, and Dale locked him up a little bit there.
Yes, he did, and I think he figures that he's got to make his move quick if he's going to be able to do it at all, because once Martin really gets settled in, he's had the car that would stay out front all day long, and come into turn 5, coming into turn, out of turn 6 now, down this straightaway. Gearing down, Earnhardt will run in on him coming into this turn. They don't think he'll be able to do anything with him here because Mark has been so good here all day long. Even though he does move in close, Martin holds away.
Mark really accelerates off turn 7, has been accelerating so well all day. But right now, a lot of pressure on Mark Martin because he realizes it's up to him. If he doesn't make a mistake, he probably will win this race. But if he makes a mistake, he is going to lose. All he's got to do is drop a tire off the racetrack. Anything can go wrong, and he can lose this race because, look,
oh, he just
a little bit right there. Might give Earnhardt the opportunity.
Good point. He's under tremendous pressure. He sets his own destiny here with what happens in the next 8 laps. But once again, we see him edging ahead by a half a car length or so as Jeff Gordon continues to run third. Here are Ken Schrader and John Andretti. This is the battle for 11th position between these two.
And Schrader takes the position away. Kyle Petty is right in front of him there now. With Kyle running in 10th place.
Buddy Barnes, one of the crewmen on the 37 car the other day, told me he was very, very impressed with John Andretti on a road course. He said, we just might have ourselves another Tim Richmond. And wouldn't that be awesome?
John Andretti won his first and only IndyCar race on a temporary street circuit in Adelaide, Australia a few years ago. So he has won on road courses.
And we see Rusty Wallace all the way back at the end of the line after making those trips up. He and Dale Jarrett.
Here's Jeff Gordon trying to make a pass on Dale Earnhardt here in turn 7, but he couldn't make it work. Mark Martin moved out to about a 10-car length lead there, but Gordon all over Earnhardt. That's one advantage that Mark Martin has right now is he's hoping that Earnhardt will worry about Jeff Gordon and not so much about trying to take the lead, but I don't think Earnhardt's going to play that game. As a matter of fact, here comes Earnhardt right on the back bumper of Mark Martin. Swings out wide, trying to get under Mark as they come off turn 11. But not able to do it this time.
Mark Martin won the most recent race on a road course at Watkins Glen last year. He also won at the Glen in 93, trying to win his third road course event.
Is there something wrong with Mark Martin's car? The Earnhardt has closed up right on the back bumper. We've not seen this all day.
Well, Earnhardt is poised. There's no doubt about that.
Now, I don't believe there's anything wrong with Mark's car. I think he's just being so careful to not do what you said that he could not afford to do, Benny. Just keeping that car on the racetrack and not making mistakes.
While we watch the battle up front, we'll tell you that the 90 car of Mike Wallace has been black flagged again. Jeff Gordon looking outside of Earnhardt.
Well, he really gets through this turn good, Bob, but he's not good enough to make a pass this time around.
Jerry, is there a problem with Mark?
Bob, there's no problem with Mark Martin. I just asked Steve Hill. He said, hey, we don't have a problem. Our lap times are about what they were before, but the three car has turned up the wick here in these final laps. Earnhardt has gotten better. I don't know where, but he has gotten awfully good these last few laps, and he's worrying us right now.
There's Steve Meehl. Down in turn 11 once again.
Mark just accelerates off all these corners so well. That's been his strong suit today. That car really gets hooked up coming off the corners.
Six laps to go. Kyle Petty and John Andretti racing side by side for 12th position.
Andretti trying to take it away. Well, this is a tough place to try to make a pass on, but they're working so far. A lot of cars behind them wish they'd get singled out, and finally they did. Kyle held on to the position.
Boy, some of those cars go way up on those rumble strips and look like they're going to overturn there.
Isn't that a great shot as those right sides come off the ground? And
wow.
To see Kyle Petty going to corner smoke that right front tire. Gary Cope, the main and tail car behind John Andretti. Bobby Labonte, Morgan Shepherd, Bobby Hamilton. All these cars racing for position.
Schrader has battle scars on that race car, but he's in the top 10.
Yeah, he's had about everything that can go wrong that they go wrong.
Just ahead of him is ninth place Jeff Bodine, on whose car we ride right now.
And then in turn 11, once again, Earnhardt closes in right on the back bumper of Mark Martin, but again, Martin comes off the corner, and Kyle Petty got off in the grass in turn 11 as we watch Mark Martin again drive away from Dale Earnhardt. And we see Earnhardt once again drive up on the back bumper of Mark Martin.
Boy, he is keeping the pressure on, but he knows how to do that. No one knows how better.
Man, he's driving that car. Both those guys driving that thing for all their worth.
While we watch this battle, we'll tell you that Rusty Wallace is back in 27th position, battling with Dave Marcus there, who's 26th.
Bob, actually, he was in front of Dave Marcus the last time he came into turn 7, and Rusty almost lost it again. Marcus got back by him, and now he's back to try to catch him again.
So down in turn 6.
while. The leaders are going through the S's, and still no change up front.
No change up there. Earnhardt staying close to Martin, but now Gordon has dropped a few car lengths behind where he was a little bit ago when he was challenging Earnhardt.
Okay, now, historically during this race, at this point of the race, Martin starts putting just a little bit of distance on Dale Earnhardt. Let's see if he can do it now, or will Earnhardt close back up? Earnhardt closes up right on the back bumper of Martin. But watch as this babbling Ford accelerates off the corner.
They're hustling all over the track. Watch Todd Bodine and Jeff Bodine side by side.
Man, that's up at turn seven, isn't it, Ned?
And Todd Bodine gets very, very high coming off the turn as his brother tried to make the pass, but he didn't play. So, big brother, I'm going to hold on to this position right now, please.
They were battling, by the way, for eighth position.
Mark Martin going up the carousel. Turn six, down the hill.
We'll tell you that Kyle Petty continues to fall back. He's back to 21st position at the moment after a very impressive early run.
Man, look at Earnhardt, Ed.
He's coming right in on him. He's trying to do something here. He's giving it everything he has, Benny, but he just can't do it.
They say in baseball, the pitcher reaches back and gets a little more.
Yeah.
Earnhardt has reached back to get just a little more.
As far as he can reach.
Turn 11. Earnhardt right on the back bumper, trying to get underneath Martin as he comes off the corner, but Martin runs that good line, accelerates, and once again, Earnhardt can't do it.
Now we're down to just three laps to go on this 2.5 mile road course. I thought he was
going to
do it there.
So did I, Bob. I thought he was
going
to
try to dive under him.
Yeah.
I don't think that would have been the place to do it. He just gained that position, that distance that he was behind, and just worked on the mind of Mark Martin a little bit more.
Boy, Mark just under tremendous pressure, both physically and psychologically, to keep Earnhardt back there.
All right, Ned, they're coming right to you. What's he going to do this time?
Well, he'll try to make a move. You can rest assured. Let's see. Is he going to try it on the inside or the outside? Martin comes down low. Earnhardt's going to try to go up high. That's not going to work for him, I don't think. But boy, he is right on his bumper coming off there. But as you've been saying, Denny, that Ford accelerates so good, even though Martin got a little bit loose that time coming off the turn.
And you can see because Earnhardt stays right on the back bumper. And Martin catches a lot of that rumble strip that time.
Oh, this looks like a Talladega draft.
There's a right-hander turn 10. They will straighten out and come towards me. Earnhardt, he's on the outside. That means he's going to try it on the inside. Oh, baby. Now, he's been trying on the outside, trying on the outside. Next time, he'll try it on the inside.
Well, I tell you, we're talking about the pressure that's on Mark Martin there. Yes, there is a lot, but I tell you, this is the way they want to do it. There's a big crowd here, what, over 100,000 or something. This is the way they want to finish a race, is racing as hard as they can possibly go for it, because when you get in victory lane, it means so much more as Earnhardt gets a little loose coming through there.
He sure did. The rear end got around on him that time, but he didn't lose.
Oh! Man, Mark's trying to turn that six car over, isn't he? Oh, Earnhardt! Not on the back bumper. Oh, folks, I don't know if you're getting excited, but I am.
I wouldn't want a steady dive to this, but I really look forward.
Here we go.
He's got him on the inside of turn six.
Never could have thought he'd made the pass there, but he did it. Now let's see if Martin do anything with him here coming into seven. Now, Earnhardt's got a bigger lead.
Yeah.
Got a good lead coming in here, and he's been getting through this corner good. Both of them have. Martin's car slides kind of in there pretty hard. He kept under control now. Jeff Gordon moves up on Martin, and Earnhardt pulls away.
Something has gone wrong with Martin's car or something. Here's how it happened.
Up in turn six, the carousel, and Martin gets the car sideways as he gets in the corner, and Earnhardt just drove by. Boy, he took advantage of that little bit of a wiggle that Mark's car made there, and just drove right on by. And here comes Dale Earnhardt towards me as the leader of the St. Mark Supermarket 300, and Jeff Gordon trying his best.
Oh, he almost lost it.
And he's in jeopardy of losing third spot to Ricky Rudd.
In any case, Dale Earnhardt sees the white flag indicating one more lap to go, and Jeff Bodine has spun from ninth position.
He was trying to pass his brother on the outside. He's trying to get going down the direction, and he turns right in front of Dale again. All right. Man.
This is the last lap. Here's Jeff and Todd.
Jeff on the outside, down in turn 11, and we saw that before, just around he went.
Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt now has the lead of the St. Mark's Supermarket 300. Mark Martin, back on pace, is within a car length or so. Jeff Gordon runs third, then Rudd and Labonte.
Here's Earnhardt coming into turn seven for the last time. He's going to come in a little bit easier this time than he's been coming. Martin will close in on him. Gordon closes in on Martin. Martin gets right up with a car length. But Earnhardt, going through here easy, was able to accelerate off that turn. That's exactly what he wanted to do. Keep the car in as straight a line as he possibly could, because he knows it's going to be tough to pass down through here. The only problem he has now, Benny, is down there at you. Turn 11, that's right. That's what Mark Martin's only hope is, to outbreak Dale Earnhardt in turn 11. But Earnhardt is just getting out of the corner a little bit better than Mark. Here they come. Earnhardt comes out of the corner. Mark down in the corner.
They come through the corner, and for the first time in his NASCAR Winston Cup career, Dale Earnhardt wins on a road course. There's a checkered flag. He beats Mark by about three car lengths. Jeff Gordon, Ricky Rudd, Terry Labonte, and Ted Musgrave are following. It's his second win of the 95 season, his 65th career win. Now look at Rusty Wallace still trying to pick off positions as he comes alongside Ward Burton.
And Richard Childress is an Africa. He missed this today. Earnhardt winning his first road course.
How about that? He took the lead coming to the white flag on the white flag lap. Dale Earnhardt wins here at Sonoma. There's the happy Richard Childress crew.
Well, caught up with Andy Petrie, and Andy, congratulations on an outstanding effort today.
Thanks a lot. You know, it means a lot to this team to win a road course race. It's not the Daytona 500, but it's something that Dale's never won, a road course race. I think he's the best driver that ever lived, and he deserves to win a road course race.
You made no changes on the car, but this incredible run those last nine laps was something to see.
Yeah, we made air pressure adjustment on that last stop, and I thought it was going to hurt us there with all those caution flags we had. If we got some green flag running, we thought we'd be good, but boy, what a driver, huh?
Hey, what a crew here. Andy Petrie and the crew getting the first road course win for Dale Earnhardt at Sears Point Raceway.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
Listen, so many people are making the smart move to Firkins, Chrysler Plymouth Jeep Eagle in Bradenton.
For his citrus business, my husband drives a four-wheel Jeep from Firkins. I wanted my own Grand Cherokee, so we became a two-Jeep family. I love my Jeep, and I love Firkins' great service.
As a home builder, I really use my Firkins Jeep. And since my wife and sons also drive Firkins cars, you know we're pleased with the dealership. We wouldn't take a chance anywhere else.
Hurry in and make the smart move to Firkins today.
There was no mistake about it. I was definitely in cruiser heaven. Even my wife looked somehow different. And there I was, prowling the streets on the new Kawasaki Vulcan 800. V-twin rumbling, chrome gleaming in the sun. Is this for real, or am I just dreaming?
The Vulcan 800 from Kawasaki.
Let the good times roll at Granny's, 2095 17th Street in Sarasota.
Alpha Gun Protectant. Nothing works better on your car's leather, vinyl, and rubber. It can turn just about anything into a great-looking car.
Nice car.
What, this pile of junk?
Give it the gun. STP Son of a Gun. And now clean your toughest tasks with Citrus Scent Cleaner Degreaser.
Now eating at McDonald's gets you the biggest break ever.
I won! Yes!
It's the Monopoly game, only at McDonald's. With over 50 million prizes, it's supersized excitement.
I want a Sonic Viper!
Shopping sprees, cruises,
Sega Game Gear with Sonic Triple Trouble.
Get a game piece on these favorites like a medium soft drink. Win big instantly, or collect a Monopoly and win. So go directly to McDonald's and eat, play, win.
$1 million!
Have you had your break today?
On June 24th, the world changes. Ice becomes concrete. Water becomes sky. And endurance becomes survival. World-class competition becomes extreme as athletes come together in Rhode Island to acknowledge the brave new world of extreme sports. The Extreme Games on ESPN and ESPN2 begins June 24th. The world as you know it has changed.
Out of here.
Okay, go ahead,
come out. He's coming out. No, you don't take the steering wheel.
Yeah, I do.
It changes. There we go.
Right.
Teresa.
You think they're happy in victory lane against Teresa? A big hug and a huge smile for Dale Earnhardt. And Dale, congratulations. What a run those last nine laps.
Well, I've won a road course. Maybe I break the ice and win Daytona next year.
You said coming into the year, you said there's three things I wanted to do. I want that eight championship, and I want a Daytona 500, and I got to win one on a road course. Well, you're part of the way there.
Well, so I tell you, Richard said he's going to Africa on a little excursion. He did. He said, y'all probably win a race while I'm gone. If that takes it, I'll go to Africa every year. So he's going to Africa next year, whether he knows it or not, for the Daytona 500. But, you know, his team and... Andy, all of us, they worked really great. I can't say enough about spinning the motors and Andy Petrie. All the guys at the shop, they just do such a good job, Jerry. And, you know, we worked hard. We've gotten a couple wrecks here lately. And you know, we just work hard as we can. It's just week in, week out. I don't know why we hadn't won a road course until now. We've been close. I sat there behind Mark and ran a real good, smooth race. And, you know, everybody that pressured me from behind just wasn't a contender. I could just take care of my tires and just move on. But Mark had really beat me off these long corners. The last couple laps, somebody threw some grease out. And that was a little deterrent. And he slipped and slid. He slipped out on the carousel, and I got under him, and that's all it took. Then I could hold him off. He could spin and slip, and trying to get back by me, it wasn't as easy. So I just helped my line runner smooth and didn't do much. Just eased her line.
It was an Earnhardt sweep for the weekend. His driver, Rod Hornaday, wins yesterday. And Dale Earnhardt wins his first ever on the road course today at Sears Point Raceway. Back with more after this.
In Normal, Illinois, Gene Goble is popular with folks who need their car fixed. He does good work, and he doesn't charge an arm and a leg. Because when he needs auto parts, Gene buys a lot of them at AutoZone. You see, the prices are low every day at AutoZone. So a lot of good mechanics like Gene just pass the savings on to their customers. Plus, they can still get the best quality parts. Sure, they know how to do the work right, but they also know how to save money doing it at AutoZone.
How light is the new Feather Life gas trimmer from Weed Eater? Well, at up to 33% less than the nearest competitor, it's the world's lightest. How quiet is the new Feather Life gas trimmer from Weed Eater? Now, let's just say it won't threaten your domestic tranquility. How well does the new Weed Eater Feather Light Trim Grass, the world's lightest gas-powered trimmer, performs like a heavyweight?
Put 700 of the world's most powerful horses together, and what do you get? You get out of the way.
The Budweiser Ken Schrader Stock Car. See you at the races.
ESPN Speed World, being brought to you from Sonoma by Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life. By Allied Signals, Autolite spark plugs guaranteed for 2 years, no matter how far you go. And by Smooth Bush Beer and Easy Drinking Bush Light. Bush, the official beer of NASCAR. Here's John Kernan.
Mark Martin, who finished second. Mark, looks like you had it, but Earnhardt got you there at the end.
They ran really good, and somebody was losing oil out there at the end, and we were first one to it and ran right through it. I couldn't see it. I'd felt it a couple of turns before and was looking for it, couldn't see it, and it just turned sideways. I mean, you win some, you lose some.
Well, Mark Martin finishes second, moves into second in the points, Bob.
Indeed, good finish here this afternoon. Dale Earnhardt coming back from problems last weekend on the last lap and takes the lead near the end of the race for the victory. Thanks, Ned, for your help down there in turn seven.
A lot of fun. A lot of cars in the lead lap here.
BP, did you eat a lot of food down there?
Quite a bit. I was right by all the food.
I figured that. There's the unofficial rundown. And the top five in points now. Earnhardt is all alone in first place. Mark Martin picks up one. Jeff Gordon back one. Sterling Marlin and Ted Musgrave remain in fourth and fifth position. There was a race here yesterday. We'll show it at 12:30 Eastern Time Tuesday morning. That's 9:30 tomorrow night here on the West Coast. Thanks to John and Dr. Punch and Ned and Benny. We will see you again on July 4th weekend in Daytona for the Pepsi 400. See you on Speed Week at 12:30 Friday night. This is Bob Jenkins. So long, everyone.